What do you want your life to look like? What do you want? And then find somebody who has that life and start finding out what's their routine. When they wake up in the morning, what are they doing? What are their mindset? How they spending their money? How they spending their time? Because we human. If another human does it, it means that we're capable of doing it.
This week, our show is brought to you by our partner in crime, Organifi. Organifi is an organic superfood supplement line that makes quality, trusted nutrition convenient and accessible. Their most popular product, green juice, can supercharge your life, restore that glow, and help you feel decades younger in just 30 seconds per day without having to worry about shopping for ingredients, mixing and blending them, and then cleaning up afterwards. All ingredients are USDA organic, vegan-friendly, and made without GMO ingredients, gluten, or soy. Where else can you get superfoods like chlorella, moringa, spirulina, wheatgrass, ashwagandha, and turmeric, just to name a few? So make sure you guys check it out at www.organifi.com/success. That's organifi.com/success. Listen, we have too much going on, period. I said it, we don't spend enough time doing the things we love or even with our loved ones. Worse yet, we find cheap and unhealthy substitutes to fill many other gaps in our lives. HelloFresh. That's right, meet HelloFresh. We all know that eating out isn't the healthiest alternative, and while it may save you time now, it costs later. HelloFresh is the answer. With America's number one meal kit, get fresh, easy, seasonal recipes and pre-measured ingredients delivered right to your door. All you have to do is cook and enjoy. For a limited time only, get 10 free meals with HelloFresh. Go to HelloFresh.com/success10 and enter success10.
I wake up every single day, I am who I say I am, and I get what I get because I live in beast mode. Being gazelles, you're not average. You're not even good. You were born to be great.
What's going on, world? Welcome to another edition of the Secret to Success podcast. I'm your host, CJ, joined as always by the Bayesian sensation, Mr. Carl Wesley Phillips.
With the big mic. Let me just call it out. They got me with the big mic today.
Big mic.
No doubt. We also got Dr. King in the building. What's going on, Jay King?
I have a dream.
He's got a tight shirt on, so he's definitely ready to pod. You know what I'm saying? He's ready to go. I came to pick him up this morning from his room, like, yo, let's go. He was in there doing push-ups. I'm like, okay, it's going to be that kind of pod. To my right, I got Dr. Douglas Thomas in the building.
What's up, man?
Man, and last but certainly not least, oh,
Thank you.
Last but certainly not least, we have a returning guest. Returning champion. It's like when you win Jeopardy. You know what I'm saying? That's you get right, to come back right. For the Champions Classic.
Did she win Jeopardy?
She did. Yeah, absolutely. She did win. Miss Tiffany Montgomery is back. Welcome.
Good day, mate.
Good day. We are in London. Tiffany tried her accent on the crowd, and they was like, that's Australia.
That's their first cousins.
Exactly.
That's
their first cousins, so we good.
Yeah, no question. So, right off the cuff, huh?
No questions asked.
As you can see, he's on keto this morning. You know what I'm saying? Straight to the croissant.
Straight. That's all they got here, look like it.
As you know, when you're overseas, you kind of got to get on a different routine, different schedule, so I'm not sure what time it is back in the States, maybe like 1, 2 a.m., but you know, the show must go on, so I appreciate y'all joining us. I have an exciting announcement to make.
We ain't got no sound effects.
No, yeah, exactly.
Oh, wow. Make up some of y'all.
No,
exactly. Edit some here.
Have a little croissant with your jelly. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, now he gonna judge me. My croissant. I got to eat it the way he would eat it.
Hey, he's back. You know what I'm saying?
How you do it out here? Pick your finger up?
Yeah, you got it. Make sure you put your finger up. I'm a free agent. I'm a free agent. I'm leaving iPhone.
Oh,
yeah, I'm leaving iPhone. Now, I ain't left yet because I don't have nowhere else to go. But I'm making myself, I'm done. I'm done.
What?
I'm done.
This is shocking news, bro.
I'm tired of it, dog. I'm tired of being treated like this. I'm tired of being disrespected with the high-priced phones and the no technology upgrades.
No technology upgrade.
I have a problem with this. I know we said it a while ago. It's like a bad marriage that you just can't leave. It's like, man, it's like your spouse is abusive and you just can't get out.
Hey, bro, I thought the nuptials said in sickness and in health.
Listen, I never took no nuptials with them.
Till death do us part.
They look sick right now.
No, I mean, but I'm saying, though, I do have, like, some real beefs with them. And the first one stems from the fact that I'm tired of the systems all being connected.
I thought that was the advantage.
I don't know, but somebody FaceTimed me the other day and my son picked up on his iPad. I'm like, what? And I turned the thing off. I was like, duh.
Oh, that's spooky.
Spooky.
That's spooky.
Trey like, hey, what up? A matter of fact, you FaceTime me and Trey answered. I wasn't even in the same state.
I'm like, put your dad on the phone.
He was like, oh, my dad ain't here. And Maul Corman was like, hey, I just FaceTimed you. Trey picked up in Atlanta.
Wow, in Atlanta.
In Atlanta.
I'm like,
where was you at?
I don't know. I can't remember. I might have been in Michigan. But yeah, so anyway, not only that, I'm just tired of, like, every time, every time they come out with a new phone, it's just a better camera. They slow your phone down.
Faster
I'm just tired.
Processing.
So, I'm just saying, Cricket, Boost.
Come on, at your boy.
Android.
Come on, at your boy.
Whoever else is out there, I'm ready to go. So
this is how you know it's bad. I didn't even know. Man, I just was like dealing with it. I never even said that. I'm like a chick getting abused, don't even want to say
that. Yeah, exactly.
I never even said anything about it. But my texts, all of them just erased.
Ooh, erased?
All of them just gone.
Oh, yeah, I believe that. Yeah,
so it's like, I'm like, you know, I keep a file of all my texts. Then one day I get on, it just gone. And I was like, when it first happened, I was like, what did I hit? I was like, all right, don't even worry about it. Don't do it again. Then the next time, like 4 weeks later, all my stuff erased. I was just like, well, okay, this can't be a coincidence. Then 2 days later, all of them erased again. So I called my boy Teron, like, T, what's going on, bro? He was like, when you upgrade, that was an upgrade challenge. I was like, what? He was like, yeah, what you do is you go to iMessage, you cut that off, cut the phone off, cut it back on, hit that joint again, and I did it, and all my messages from 2018 came back.
Wow.
But to C's point, I wasn't going to say nothing. I was just like, yo, I'm getting abused.
No,
say
they
something.
Got a settlement
say
now.
No, you got to say something.
They got a settlement now.
Yeah, yeah. Say something.
I need to get my check.
Yeah, you got to say something.
No, you got to say something. Yeah, I feel like it's just some things you should be able to do that you can't. How come I can't search an individual text message? Because, like, you know, like, let's say you want to search a message and you just put in, like, podcast time. Yeah.
Secret to success.
I got 62 different podcast time texts. Yeah. How come I just can't go to Tiffany text and search her individual text?
Oh, you might have just given him the next upgrade.
I'm just trying to say this is basic stuff that we need. If me and E talk, I tried to find one of me and E text the other day. I was scrolling for about 8 hours, and I knew exactly what it said, but it was a key phrase or word that I used probably with some other people too.
Right, and so
but
all if I could, this stuff came up.
I'm done.
Steve Jobs is dead.
Let me tell you something. And you talk about, it's crazy, but you talk about the importance of one person and one person's vision.
No question.
I promise you, swag just ain't been the same. They need to step it up. I'm tired of being treated like
but
this.
But when you move on, is it going to be better?
How do I know if
is
I never move
greener?
On? How do I know if I never move on? I'm not happy now.
It's cheaper to keep it.
Price ain't the concern these days. Convenience is. You know what I'm saying?
I don't think the grass is greener on the other side. I think you're going to have
Let's call Android
to
see. Let's tell them what problem we having to see if Android want
to
fix it.
Exactly. It's like when you get ready to move to a different business, they like, look, what are you willing to do to keep
it?
You know what I'm saying? What are y'all willing to do?
My boy called me from, didn't we get a call from T-Mobile? They said they could save $300 a month. T-Mobile call. They won't even wait for you to leave. We got to hook up from T-Mobile. They call. We can save $300 for everybody every month. So
I feel like I already owe T-Mobile based on the Ponzi scheme me and E figured out.
Back in the day.
You know what I'm saying? I ain't going to tell y'all about the little side little, you know
side
what I'm saying?
Hustle.
It's nothing illegal. So don't, you know what I'm saying? They're going to be like, oh, what they do? But man, no, good to have everybody back.
Yeah, good to be back.
I think Tiffany sent her crew after me after the last podcast.
Yeah.
I think she had her homies, she emailed everybody and was like, go into the comments,
in
tell
the
them
millions.
I didn't do it.
I need to
she
be
had
back
millions.
And I need to talk more.
Yeah.
They didn't pass me the ball enough.
Nope.
And so I was people was hitting me up and they was like, yo, Tiffany need to talk more.
Right.
So give her the rock.
Right.
And I said, hey,
I'm the coach.
This is one of those podcasts where it's like, you know, it's a lot of shooters. You know what I'm saying? Maul has come in. And Maul is like Kirk. He gonna get his 30.
Like Kirk.
You know what I'm saying?
32 and 10.
Maul gonna get his 30.
Yeah.
Now Carl don't mind just rebounding, putting it back. He not gonna trip. But Maul trying to get 30. He coming out James Harden.
Step back. Step back.
You like E. Why did you just cross the half court line and let him fly? And
I think I'm the best in the league. So, you know what I'm saying?
Hey, you see that one thing with Kobe? When Kobe had like three or four people around him, and he wouldn't pass the ball or whatever.
Oh, yeah, no doubt. Yeah, that's E.
No question.
E. I'm open.
Hey, what they say is you look at him like, oh, okay. You open? Oh,
yeah, yeah, yeah. And the bad thing about E is he'll pump fake the pass to you.
No question.
And then you get geeked up, and he's still shooting.
I'm like, Kobe, I'm 50. He take 50 attempts, bro.
No question. So, Tiff, this time we are going to I've instructed my colleagues to pass the rock a little bit. We have been, it's been brought to my attention that we've been extremely hard on people the last few weeks. Mm. And so I told E last night at dinner, I said, hey, maybe we should let up a little bit. You know what I'm saying? Like, I feel like we've been kind of...
I think our ratings
are
going down,
what you think? It's been intense.
I think our ratings are going down, though.
No.
That's true.
But all the soft people come back. You know what I'm saying? Because I think they just peek in on the podcast like, nope, turn that off. And, you know, maybe they'll come back. But one of the things we've been talking about, people being takers, you know, people not looking out for other people. Mm. And I thought maybe we could do some more work to give out tangible steps. And he said, no, it's been tangible. Apparently you've received some phone calls,
it's been tangible.
Some texts.
I've been getting Chipotle, people just sending me all kind of Cash App stuff.
You know what I'm saying?
Calling, saying they sorry.
Yeah. So I still thought to myself, I'm like, okay, we don't want to be the podcast that, you know, berates and then doesn't give you those practical steps.
Right.
And so, if there are people out there who feel like maybe the steps haven't been practical or feel like, you know, there's some,
wardrobe malfunction.
Oh, yeah.
Malfunction.
That's why we didn't have her on.
Give me two.
Right. That's why we didn't have her on.
Give me, I don't ever want to be that podcast that does not give out those practical steps, because one of the things that I think makes E great is the fact that you don't do a lot of theory.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, and I hear a lot of people, when you hear them talk, it's a lot of theory. You hear it, you're like, okay, but I'm not exactly sure how it applies to me or how I can take that. And I had got a few texts from some people who were like, yo, I feel like you guys are stepping on my toes in a good way. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, I feel the pressure. And, you know, as I evaluate my life, I do think about myself first, and I do make moves and actions based on my best interest and maybe not the group and things like that. And they were saying to me, how do I come out of that in a world where it seems like everybody else is on that and I'm getting left behind? And so in their mind, again, at the same time, I've heard you say, E, it's a dog-eat-dog world.
Absolutely.
And so you're telling me to basically become, you know, the sheep when I'm around a bunch of wolves.
Mm-hmm.
And so, how do you...
Well, I didn't say that, but I feel
I'm saying, I'm telling you how they're taking it.
Okay, or at least some people. No question.
How do you maintain that level of intensity and that level of, I got to provide for my family, Malcolm, by any means necessary?
Yeah.
How do you, you know, juxtapose... See that? I got my master's degree. I don't know if you knew. But this, you know what I'm saying? I'm attempting to take us to the next level.
Right, he had to wait until we get to London to start
pulling this stuff out.
Yeah. Queen's English. Yeah.
Juxtapose. You know what I'm saying?
50 Cent.
But let's talk practically, you know, for people who say, hey, I feel y'all. I feel everything you're saying. I want to be the do things for people. I want to be the lookout for your fellow man. But that's not where I come from. And that's not the norm where I'm from. And I've seen people do that and they've been burned. Mm. And so, E, I think maybe you could start us off and speak to that again, because I think there are maybe practical steps that we can implement to where we can not be a taker and still provide for ourselves at a very high level, provide for our family, and go after what's ours. You know what I mean?
Yeah, man, that's pretty deep, see, especially this early. you know what I'm saying? But no, just
we'll have another croissant.
Right. You know, light it up.
Some more jelly.
Give me some more jelly, please. you know what I'm saying? Please. But serious, you know, I Gandhi said it best. You know, Gandhi was like, if you treat your opposer the way they treat you, he was like, yo, like, you know better. You know what I'm saying? It's like, you don't like the way they treat you, and then you turn around and do the same thing. So for me, I see it two ways, see? Yeah, we do live in a dog-eat-dog world, and I gotta grind, but I'm not gonna change philosophically what I believe. And I believe that with the same measure that you give, it shall be given unto you. Like, for real, for real. And I say this because there are people who have philosophies and it sounds good. Like, they say stuff because it sounds good, but they don't necessarily live by it. Like, I literally, every day when I wake up and I'm making moves, I'm asking myself, like, yo, E, is what you're doing right now going to press down, shaking together? Is it going to run over? You know what I'm saying? Like I'm for those of you listening, like, listen, I'm being real. If I go to the grocery store, I'm saying to myself, how can I plant a seed at this grocery store? I go to Chipotle. Even though I'm going, I need you to hear me. Even though I'm going to eat, I'm looking in the restaurant and I'm asking myself, is there an opportunity for me to be a blessing while I'm in here? I'm at the gas station. I'm putting gas in my car, but I'm looking around like, is there? Now, I don't mean every time you go somewhere, you got to bless somebody, but I'm always conscious of, I am being blessed. It's like a two-way boy. I'm going to get something, but is there an opportunity for me to give while I'm getting? Because the Dead Sea is the Dead Sea because it takes, but it doesn't give. That's why it's the Dead Sea. It receives, but it doesn't give. So I'm always making sure, all right, I'm being blessed, but am I being a blessing? Are we going back and forth? So yes, we live in a dog-eat-dog world. See, and we do got to get up. We got to go out there and we got to get it. We got to have that mentality that ain't nobody going to give you nothing. But that's how you're responding to the world.
Right.
You're not necessarily making the world make you respond the way they respond. But I am conscious of, I got to play offense and defense in this world. Like, I can't just be on offense or I just can't be on defense. So I'm saying practically for those of you, you know, who are listening, it's like a bank account. You can't always withdraw. If you always withdraw, at some point you're going to go to the bank and there's not going to be nothing in the bank. So when you think about a bank, what do? You put in, you deposit, you take out. But you should be putting more in than you're taking out so that when you have a need, that money is there. So I just want people to look at it as a bank. You can't keep withdrawing. I think it's called overdraft. And at some point, they cancel.
It costs.
Yeah, right. And it costs. And if you keep doing it, you're negligent. I think they close your account. So I just want you to think of every relationship. And look, man, it's hard. See, when you're in a relationship, bruh, and people are blessing you, like, it's so easy to get comfortable and just chill. It's like, yo, I'm just being real, bruh. Mm-hmm. Like, this feel good. Like, you're with somebody who's constantly blessing you. It's like, you know, in a marriage, you can have a wife that's cooking, that's cleaning, whatever, and you just get to a point where it's like, yo, this feel good to be spoiled. Like, let's just be real. It feels good to be spoiled. It feels good to be pampered. But at some point, if the person that's pampering you get burnt out, you can't get pampered no more. You feel me? So common sense is, let me at least do enough for this person that's babied me so I can keep getting babied. But if you burn me out like a child, they don't know no better. They suck in the breast, they up at night, you ain't getting no sleep. It's
everything.
Like, you might want to tell the baby, like, chill out now, because you about to wear your mama out, and then you're not going to have it. So I just think, see, people need to see, yep, there's nothing wrong with getting blessed, but if you just keep taking, you're going to burn that person out, and then you're not going to have that person no more. So even if you're selfish, just look out for the person that's looking out for you so they can keep looking out for you, if that makes sense.
So I was going to say real quick, what I like about what you said, Ida, so deep is, like, you're looking to give, and I want people to move away from money.
Right.
Like, we ain't talking about money. Your concept is, I'm looking to bless.
Yeah.
I told my son, he jumps out the car first every morning. I was like, dude, don't you go in that school without opening the door for your sister. Right. You faster.
Right.
Right? So you jump out the car, run up to the thing. Yeah. I'm like, no, your sister is walking behind you. Right. Run up. But have a reason why you're running up. You running up there to open the door for her. And I was like, yo, open a door for somebody. Right. We ain't got to be deep.
Right.
Look for an opportunity to give. And I think that's important. Like, if you start there, I don't care how you give. You know what I'm saying? Whatever you have to give. Yeah.
The little drummer boy.
That's all I got. You know what I'm saying? I ain't got all that.
Can I play my drum for you?
Whatever you got, make sure you're looking for an opportunity to give that. Yeah. So that's
and also
big.
When you look for the opportunity to give, make sure you're not looking for them to give it back.
Because even
when you have a giving heart, you know what I'm saying? Your motives might be taking, which means when I gave to you, when you gonna give it back to me? And you can't. So as soon as you give to somebody, like in my mind, as soon as I give to somebody, I forget that I gave it to them.
Right.
But I do expect to get paid back, because that's
but by who?
By God.
You feel me?
And whenever you give to somebody else has to give it back to me at the same measure. So I forgot that I gave it to you. It's like mentally I make sure I forgot. So I'm not holding you hostage or bound to pay me back something you couldn't pay me anyway. That's why I had to give it to you.
Right.
And everybody, man, look, if you, so all those people out there that you're talking about, as far as the say everybody else is doing it, you want to stand out.
Right.
This has always been my whole thing.
I got you.
I always, if I see 99 people going to the right, I'm going to go to the left. And if you want to stand out, the first thing you want to do is do the totally opposite of what everybody else is doing. Right. Everybody, if you want a room full of takers, the way to stand out is by giving.
Right.
The way to stand out is by giving. Yeah. And so those same people, because I was getting some of them text messages too and emails and stuff like that. You know.
Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. But just become a giver.
Yeah.
Like, literally, become a gift. There's a reason why people remember Santa Claus, right? Santa Claus give once a year.
Yeah.
People, because they're so excited, because he's a giver, right? Yeah. He gives once a year.
Yeah.
But don't nobody remember the Grinch. You hate the Grinch, because he takes.
Yeah.
And so in that same way, man, I found out that when you give and you're cheerful with your giving, that, like you were saying, you just don't have no anger, like, oh, man, and not expecting nothing in return. You know, it's just a different kind of mindset. Yeah. It's a different kind of joy. Matter of fact, I get excited when I give.
I do too.
I get more excited than the person that's
what's
receiving.
The transition, though, Maul? Because
let's just be real. Is that true or is that cap?
That's
one of those things.
Bro, just think about
it's almost like an adrenaline rush.
Think about
like
how we
it goes
fight.
Up to you. I'm like, you like can't sleep.
But what's the
like,
shift, though? Because were we always on this?
I wasn't.
Okay, that's what I want to talk about.
Oh, yeah,
what's the shift? How do you go from being, because listen to me, I'm going to say it again. It's better to give than receive.
Yeah, but I was not a cheerful giver.
Right, but I'm saying, here's the deal. I love that text, but it feels better to receive, though.
That's right.
I'm just saying, like, before you make that transition, I mean, I love the scripture. It's better to give than receive, but receiving feels better. At some point, like, before you make that shift, like, I'm an adult now, and of course, I feel like I love giving, and I don't really like receiving as much no more. But there was a point in my life where my mom was cooking, washing clothes, like, for real. I was geeked to be on the receiving end. What's the shift, though? How do because there's somebody listening right now, and they ain't on giving.
I was watching an episode where she gave away all those cars. I don't know how long ago that was.
What was the episode
years
of?
Years ago.
Oprah.
Yeah.
Oh, Oprah,
Years ago.
She said, like, her's her auntie. Like, we were just in the mid. She gave away cars. I'm like, who gave away cars? My auntie. Yeah. Oh, okay.
She was giving away all those cars.
Yeah.
And I remember sitting there, what was that, 20 years ago, maybe 15 years ago? It was a long time ago. And I sat there and I thought I would have been excited to be in the audience getting a car. But the joy I got watching her give it was I never forgot that moment because that was the first moment I felt joy watching somebody give. And I said, I have to do that one day. And it wasn't that, like, I got a car. I was like, oh, I got to do that. I have to give one day.
Even bought a car yesterday.
Right, but it was that shift. Like it was that moment, that shift. So it was after that. I was like, oh, I need to give like that. Like I need that. I want that feeling that I sat there and watched.
So you
it
put
on
yourself
TV.
In the giver's seat.
But you know what's so crazy? Because they always say don't show your giving, which is true, right. Depending on your motive. But it was me watching.
Oh no,
that,
I don't agree with that.
Well, I do. I do in certain instances.
He said he
wanted
to be petty.
Yeah.
I do it in certain instances. It's motives that matter, right?
Yeah.
But when I watched her do it, it turned something on in me that said, oh, I got to do that. And if she had did it privately, I wouldn't have had that moment, like that moment. But ever since then, I made sure in small instances I gave where I could and anything I could, whatever it was. So my point is, like, whenever I get with somebody, I'm like, how can I overgive to them? Yeah. Whether it's not might be money, but anything.
Yeah, absolutely.
And in my mind, I'm like, I'm going to overgive. And if you give, I'm like, I'm going to overgive some more. But you don't know we doing an overgive competition.
Yeah, no question about that.
Mind.
Yeah, it's a generosity.
Overgive competition.
Yeah, it's generosity. You'll never outgive me. Yeah. I've already made it up.
No question.
Mind.
But I guess, do you know, to E's point, what was the shift? It was just seeing that?
Oh, no, it was literally that moment. Yeah. That was a powerful moment for me.
For the culture.
But a lot of people Oprah were excited about getting the car.
But I think Oprah, for a lot of us, though, was the first person we saw on that level give. Oprah was doing it regularly.
So it
became like a Kevin Hart joke that everybody's telling it. It becomes a part of the culture. Ha Ha Dave is telling the joke.
Yeah.
You know, you serious. It became a part.
I didn't see any other giver or philanthropist.
Oprah, Oprah was one of the first ones to do that.
Major philanthropists do it privately, which I think is important.
Yeah.
But she was the first one I saw tangibly give. And I was like, there was something that happened or broke through. And I was like, I got to do that one
day. And for everybody, though, Oprah, remember, everybody's like, and you get a, and you get a,
you
and
know,
you
some
get a.
Complained about the car. They was like, they gotta pay taxes on it. They were pissed.
Yeah, that's take a mentality.
Even in receiving, they still take it.
You remember those people?
You still take it. I gotta put gas in the car.
Yeah, they were pissed. They said, we don't get gas for this. You're just gonna give us a car.
Yeah.
I'm like,
wow. Yeah, that's what take.
Give me the car back. I take the car. I give it to somebody else.
Incredible.
I'm grateful. You know, it is crazy when you do that to see the way people react. I remember there's also people going like, oh, she had to do that for tax purposes anyway.
Wow.
You know what I mean? Like, you just get people who...
She could have bought a plane.
Right.
But, you know, again, when you do something or when you get to that level, I think that it's important to set that example. So for E, you talked about yesterday, it was crazy because when people were sending me these texts about these last few podcasts and stuff like this, and they like, but what about? I'm like, man, who are y'all around on the regular that's treating y'all this way? And it was crazy. You said something deep yesterday. We had to put this clip out, and maybe by the time this comes out, you'll already have it. But you said something about, like, you teach people how to treat you. And, of course, you've heard that a bunch of times.
Absolutely.
But he said, like, your creditors, if you will. He said, you got a 400 credit score. They treat you a certain way because you've shown that you don't care about yourself. Your own credit in that manner. So now I'm about to overtax you. I'm about to talk to you crazy on the phone. Like, it's a different... Yeah. You roll into the bank with a 400, 500 credit score. It's a different way they treat you as opposed to somebody who got an 850.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? Yeah. And so when everybody was texting me, I'm like, dog, who y'all around on a regular basis that feel comfortable treating you like this that way anyway?
Right.
So walk us through then, I guess, everybody... how to teach people how to treat you so that you don't have these types of interactions on a daily basis. Because I'm like, y'all in the jungle.
Oh, boundaries.
I'm not in that anymore. You know what I mean? Like,
It's boundaries.
Yeah.
It's just like what you're not going to do.
Yeah.
That's really it.
Yeah.
It's not really systematic. Yeah. And I think the lower your self-esteem is, the more you're open to allowing people to treat you any type of way. But what you're not going to do is treat me like that. And how you're not going to talk to is that. Mm-hmm. And what you're not going to say is that. And once you start putting those boundaries in place, people stop and think, but you got to open up your mouth and say it like, hey, don't talk to me like that. And they're like, oh, I can't talk to you like that? No, you can't talk to me like that. Yeah. You can talk to everybody else like that, but watch your mouth with me.
But I think you have to stop talking to you like that.
Oh, for sure.
You know what I'm saying?
That's exactly where it
started. I don't think you tell C, don't talk to me like that. I think you got to tell yourself.
I mean, it goes even small. Like when people say, oh, you so crazy. And if you grew up with people saying that to you or... in a negative connotation, people say that as a joke. You say, I'm not crazy. Don't say that to me no more.
Yeah.
And he might say to anybody else in the world, but they won't say to me anymore. Right. So it starts with you saying
to
yourself.
Yeah, you saying it to yourself that I'm not crazy.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, so for me, see, I think, man, you know, first, when you know, my mom used to say, if you hang around nine broke people, you're bound to be the 10th. I think for me,
the first thing I had to do was
nickel slip.
Right,
sucker,
right,
you.
Yeah, sucker MC. Sucker MC. You know what I'm saying? I had to get to the point where it was okay for me not to be with the nine.
Okay.
You know? Because that, like, because I felt bad when I first started doing good for me.
But would you rather
me,
be with solo or with the nine?
Solo.
No, I'd rather be with the nine.
Solo.
I'm just saying, there was a point in my life I'd rather be with the nine than be by myself.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And then I actually felt bad when I would get with a Jamal who was, like, on something positive. Why? Because I would only be around Mar for a minute, and when with the nine, they dogging me out for being with you. So the stress that I had to go through with my community, it was just like, yo, I don't even know if I want to, like, I'm just being real.
Yeah.
It, like, you know, and I make this analogy just because, you know, like you said, how I feel about working out. Like, that ain't necessarily my thing, right? And I used to tell myself, Maul, it was crazy. I had to reprogram my mind because I used to say, is this worth doing this? Like, I'm just being real. Like, I get on a treadmill for an hour and run, and then I'm looking at a honey bun. That's like, that honey bun was worth my whole hour. You know what I'm saying? But I'd be like, I wouldn't look at it as it's my whole hour. I'd be like, well, that honey bun, I can eat that joint now. I just ran off 600 calories I could hit that honey bun.
Right.
Like, I wasn't on, don't do the hour because you just did the hour, so don't eat the honey bun.
Yeah.
I was on, oh, I'm good now. I ran for an hour, so the honey bun ain't going to kill me. And so I think the hardest part for me when I first made the transition was you make this transition, but you still in your neighborhood.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You feel me? Like, you don't make a transition to be wealthy and then you with wealthy people. I wasn't with Dan Gilbert. We don't hang out like that. I wasn't with Warren Buffett like that on no red. Matter of fact.
Yo, Dan, I changed my mindset, dog. I'm about to come up to Quicken Loans.
You feel me?
I'm on my way.
No, no. Even when Dan Gilbert gave me an opportunity to have an officer next to him, I didn't even do it at first, bro. And then even when I did it, I didn't do it regularly. Like, I got an office right across. I never even did it. Me and Carl might have went up there three times at best. And I had an opportunity. But I was still in my neighborhood, and I was still listening to people who say, E, now let's be real. I don't know where y'all come from, but where I come from, I'm still a minority in where I'm hanging out at. It ain't a whole bunch of, I ain't hanging around motivational speakers. I'm not hanging around the top motivational speakers in the world. I'm still hanging with people who going to work. You know what I'm saying? Like, I still live in a working community. The people in my neighborhood get up and go to work every day. Right. I'm not in a neighborhood where people don't work. You feel what I'm saying? So I'm just being real. I had to love me first. And I had to stop worrying about how they thought about me. You know what I'm saying? I'm talking about as an adult now. I ain't talking about no teenager. I'm talking about a grown man still wondering, okay, I'm traveling the world, but I'm going to a church that ain't traveling the world. I'm traveling the world, but I'm coming back to a church with people who I love who living from check to check.
Yeah.
You feel me? And they not having healthy conversations with me about me traveling the world necessarily.
Right.
It's some question stuff. Why would you go to London and turn right back around? So I'm not going to some place where they like, oh, you went to London and turned right back around. What's the next trip? It's like, oh, so why would you go to London and turn back around? How much money are you making? Like, what about your health? The coronavirus? You willing to put yourself at risk? So I'm just saying, I don't live in the world that I live in. I don't live in that world.
Right.
I don't live in the world that
not
I live in.
You
feel
Diego.
Me? I still live in, right.
You're San Diego,
right. Yeah, but I'm saying, I still live in Michigan. I still live in a working class. I still go back to people who question my way.
Yeah, but that's wrong.
It might be.
Not for you to live there,
right.
But for even somebody to open themselves up to allow people with poverty,
absolutely.
low mentality. Not saying they got low mentalities, but low mentalities to even open themselves up to questioning you if it's not boundary driven.
Oh, you're right. But I'm just saying, I'm talking about, like, we ain't talking about, and I can, his podcast, I know everybody listening, but I'm saying it's easy to talk it and let's walk it through, but sometimes it's your family.
Yeah, I get it.
Like, we ain't talking about people you can leave.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about? People you can cut off. Like, sometimes the people that's questioning you or the people that may not necessarily question you, but you don't feel them positive vibes.
But let me give you an example. This is what I mean, because I don't think it's hard. So you're saying it's not easy, and I'm saying it's very easy because I've done it with family.
Right.
And what I'm saying is, let's use weight as an example. Let's say you fit, you working out, you doing everything you need to do, and a 500-pounder is saying to you,
right.
Why are you working out like that?
Right.
It's not going to, it don't matter.
Right.
Why are you doing that? Why are you wasting sleep? You might as well just eat. You're getting too skinny.
Yeah, man.
Why would you then say, it's your own family saying why I got to work out. It's a 500 pounder. You see you see what that's giving them. Yeah. They sick, they going to the hospital, they can't breathe. Why would you even allow what they say to you to even bother you and say it's not, well, it's kind of hard to tell him. He's 500 pounds. Right. It shouldn't be hard to tell him.
Of course you know you want to be fat, though.
What if that 500 pounder is your father, though? A voice that you just so used to hearing. Yeah, but I've been
there and done that. And everybody else in your family fat. Yeah.
But it's been there and done that, but there's got to come a time where you got to break a certain generational curse so obesity, high blood pressure, the silent killer, which is heart disease, doesn't come on your family. So it's a time that you have to raise up your voice and say to your father, hey, you didn't do right. And I want you to live longer. And you need to, would you like to join me? Because a lot of the times people say that because of jealousy. And jealousy is as cruel as a grave. So you continue to open yourself up to allow them to speak to you without that mentality. Like they're actually 500 pounds, maybe not physically, but they're sick. Why would I allow sickness and say it's not easy to tell them because they family?
Sometimes it's a generational disease.
Yeah, I'm sure.
It's just what they say.
I am sure, but it takes at least one person to start saying, hey, let me hold up a mirror to you.
No question.
Because nobody's held up a mirror to you. Because even, like you said, if it's a generational disease, you know there's a thing called odor fatigue. Odor fatigue means you ever gone to somebody's house all your life and they don't smell their house? It don't stink, but they don't smell their house. But you come over and be like, man, it's the same smell. So you can have odor fatigue in the family bloodline where you're so used to everybody being like that, you don't smell what's wrong anymore. And then now you become the part of the problem because now you're with a drug addict and you're aiding and abetting in their drug using because you've always only seen them as a drug dealer. Now you don't have the outside vision to say, I can see you better than this and more than this because you got odor fatigue concerning your father. Odor fatigue concerning because it's just a generational disease. They've always been like this. And you have to say to that family member, hey, listen, this is what, there's mental illness in the family. Go get help.
No question. Yeah, but that's why I just said, though, that's that.
I was just start passing the ball to
me. Yeah. I'm just saying, though, Tim, that's why I said.
I'm the point guard.
By the way, I did. By the way, I was setting you up.
Thank you for that.
You know, I agree. I just want to make sure you weren't talking to me.
Don't acknowledge that. But here's why I'm saying what I said. Now it becomes a burden to be.
Oh, for sure. Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
So that's why some people like trying to do it.
Because they're not going to accept it easily.
Like, real, what you just said is true.
Yeah.
But now the burden is on you.
For sure.
Right. And so a lot of people don't want to do it because it's like, yo, it's easier just to be. It's easier.
But the burden is on you because you let it stay there.
Right.
No, like you need the fortitude to say, I'm not carrying your burden.
Right.
You carried this burden. Right. It's not mine. I'm not carrying it. I'm going to do what I can do to make sure you come out of this. But we all know that there's certain people with certain mindsets that no matter what you say to them, they're not going to change it. So I'm going to give you the information, but I'm not going to carry your burden of your obesity. I'm not going to carry your burden of your disease. I'm not going to carry your burden of poverty because I, for whatever reason, broke out. And I'm going to teach you everything I know just because I'm a giver in that way.
Right.
But it's up to you to change that. And I'm not carrying that burden. So I think that a lot of people...
That's another podcast. How do you not carry...
Well, no, it's not only carrying the burden, but it's do you remove yourself from...
Sometimes you do and sometimes you don't.
You can't always.
Because
I'm just saying he's the pastor of the church.
Right, but there's also boundaries of being pastor of the church. Sure. Because you also understand there's pastors that kill themselves. And there's pastors that go crazy. And there's pastors whose families are going... So his relationship with his wife is solid because he has boundaries concerning sheep. If he did not have boundaries, his marriage would be in shambles because there's a lot of pastors whose marriages are in shambles. They're on the brink of suicide. And some of them are even murdering their families. Real talk. Which means, you know, you just heard of a pastor whose wife was on the pulpit speaking and he came in and shot her on the pulpit and then killed himself. Last week.
Wow.
Yeah.
I didn't see that one.
Yeah, I'll send you the link.
Yeah.
But it's...
Send me the link.
Okay, this is crazy.
I take your word for it. You know what I'm saying? Okay. I don't got to read it. I don't think you would allow to be on the podcast.
It's boundaries because what happens is people will start thinking he's God.
Yeah.
And he's not God and he can't change their life and he can't fix their life.
Yeah.
And as a good anybody, pastor, friend, you're always supposed to be pointing people back to God because I'm not God.
Absolutely.
I can only give you certain tools as a human being, but I can't change your life. And I think that's where people get it mixed up is they think that there's some type of pseudo God that they can fix everybody's life and you can't do that.
Is there a strong pull, do you think, for you to still be around that group? Because I think when you do we talked about this the other day. It's tough when you really the only one in your circle that... You know what I'm saying?
That showed a picture. I don't know, because, you know, we all over the place. So I don't know if I talked about it in the podcast, but when I went to the furniture out the furniture district in L.A.
Right.
And I saw the Jewish kids taking a field trip to the bank. Bro, I don't know if we talked about it on the podcast, but they taking a field trip to Chase Bank. They're in middle school.
You sent me a video.
Somebody, you saw in GroupMe, somebody posted like from our church. He preached about it a couple weeks ago. Somebody in the church was like, oh, shoot, look, I see it too. Like, somebody saw it happening. So this ain't one inch.
Okay, slow down and break it down because they're listening on the podcast.
Okay, so again, like I said, it was crazy. So Didi and I, you know, we went to a furniture district in L.A. getting ready, you know what I'm saying, to make this transition. And I walked into, you know me, I'm a people, so I see it. So I see a group of kids. I thought they was at the bank, but I thought they stopped on the way to a field trip and one of the adults had to use the bathroom. You feel what I'm saying? That's what I'm thinking. I'm like, they got
to
use the bathroom.
They about to go to the zoo.
Yeah, so they like,
and they just stopped at the bank.
Yeah, so just sit right there at the bank.
You know what I'm saying?
I'm going to go use the bathroom and come back. But I noticed they lined up and they were trying to explain to the kids, like they was having a conversation with them. So they walked into the bank. We walk into the furniture district, so we go into one store, and the man sits down with Didi, and they going over some stuff. Like, they looking at the blueprint, they looking at the plans, and they going, like, measuring. So we was in there for about 45 to an hour. We leave there, we go to another little store for about 5-10, then we go across the street, she in there for about 30, 40. We come out, I see a police officer writing a ticket. He's like, E.T., what up? And we started taking pics. The dude in the car was like, E.T., tell my man to let this ticket go. I was like, I said something to the cop. He was like, it's too late. I already wrote that joke. So as soon as...
Oh, they love that reason.
No,
you ain't write it.
As soon as we finished the pic, the kids walk out the bank.
2-hour field trip.
Bruh, they walk out. And I'm thinking to myself, like, hold up. The bank ain't that big. What was you doing in the bank for 2 hours? Jamie was like, they went to the vault, right? But then it dawned on me, yo, if they in middle school, they about to get the bar mitzvah boy and another couple. You know what I'm saying? They about to get cashed out. So they probably not just on no field trip.
They
probably getting a bank account because they about to take that money that they getting and they about to put the money. You know what I'm saying? So I was like, yo, they really in there talking to a teller at 12. I mean, they're younger. It was probably 10 years old. But I was just like, yo, what kind of community are you in? That it's normal for everybody to be economically well.
We took our field trips to crack chicken.
Bruh, I'm just saying the zoo, like the zoo
is
where
we put the seasoning on.
Right. So
it's a little extra, you know, you need.
So C always talks about, what's the difference between being in a community like that versus being in a community where you're the only, one. But there are a few.
You're the minority.
Yeah, for real. Like, for real. Like, you in the one community where, you know, he talks about one of his friends. We're not going to say his name, but he might make $500,000 a year, and he's doing terrible. Like, $500,000, and his family looking at him like, you only making $500,000 a year.
Poverty-stricken.
Right. You're poverty-stricken. You're a disgrace to the family. You know what I'm saying? You made half a meal. You know, versus... If you bring it home 50, 60 grand a year,
you're killing it.
You know what I'm saying?
Let me hold something.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? So we just talked about, you know, what the difference between that, because there is a burden. And I'm just saying this.
That exposure is crazy.
It is. And so for some people, it's just, it's rough.
Oh, man. The exposure is crazy. I talked about that the other day. I wasn't sure where the black kids were in my neighborhood during baseball season. Trey was the only black kid on his team. Babe, my line, literally the only black kid on his team. And I was like, man, we moved out here. We ain't been out there that long. I'm like, I thought there was a few more black families around.
It's got to be.
Until hoop season. Yeah. I said, oh we're here. You know what I'm saying? No, I'm serious. There was one white kid on the team.
Wow.
And I was like, yo, I'm like, we're not bad at baseball.
Right.
We're not exposing our kids to baseball.
That's true.
And you think about the world and life, it's like, we didn't get exposed to banking early. Like, we might have been in basketball. We might have been taking field trips to the zoo. We might have been going to the museum, whatever. But we weren't going to the bank. We weren't exposed to that. And to Maul's point of exposure, and we talked about it again after Maul's speech yesterday, I was like, what made you want to live like this grand? And he said it in the speech, but, you know, you hear it and you're kind of like, okay, for real. And he was like, no. When I saw someone living in this manner, I was taken aback. Somebody that I knew. So I just think, like, your boy got drafted, you know, and got millions of dollars that particular way. But for those of us who are never exposed to it, and didn't have the field trip to the bank and didn't have a friend get drafted and don't see it, how do you still take it to that next level? And I guess, Maul, you could take it from there just in terms of what that exposure did for you, just seeing a mansion, seeing a $200,000 check.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, what that stirred up something inside of you. And I want to know, okay, I got it. I want to know the difference between the person who sees that and right. goes, man.
That's for them.
That's for them. And I'm going to hate on it. Yeah. And I'm pissed because you got it. And who he think he is to the person who like, that's what we doing?
Right.
Bet, let's go.
Oh, Ma, throw another group in there, though. The group that's like, my boy getting paid, I'm going to eat off of him. You know what I'm saying? That group.
We've been acknowledging that group for 6 weeks straight.
Yeah. I'm just saying, that's a group, Ma, that go, my boy doing it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I'm going to eat off of him.
Yep. Yep.
Like, he making it happen. So, he in the NFL. Remember what your boy said?
Yep.
We made it, bro.
Because he was so used to
right.
that. But think about it, man. I'll go back to the beginning. That exposure didn't necessarily come from him. If you remember the story,
right.
I had that mindset way before him.
Yeah. Mm.
He was just
chicken or the egg.
He was just the actual image in person of what I've always wanted for myself. And so I think it was a little bit disturbing when I actually saw what it looked like. Before, I just saw it on TV. I saw different NFL guys having it on TV, people that was out of touch with me.
Life
but now to see somebody that you actually went to school with, to actually know a person and say, man, like, wow, this dude got my life right now.
Yeah.
You know, that's what made
it. Slow that down, Mark.
Yeah.
Try to get that,
man, to look and see somebody that you know personally and say, man, that guy got my life. The life I dreamed of since 8 years old.
So is that
you're now living.
I'm saying, is that the problem? Because we see it everywhere now.
Well, no, the problem ain't the fact that you say this guy got my life. The problem is that you want to now either suck away from him
to get that life.
As opposed to just saying, you know what, man? I'm going to go after this also. I'm going to position myself also to get that.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that's what it was for me. Like, when I went and I saw everything that he had, it wasn't in a jealous type way.
Right.
It wasn't in a way of saying, like, man, I'm going to take it or I'm going to attach myself to it.
Yeah.
It was in a way of saying, okay, I'm getting close to it. Yeah. It's now, it's no longer just visible to me on television. Yeah. Now it's real. Because now if he can do it, it's the same thing with me and you, right?
Yeah.
You might have seen people doing real estate for years.
And I'm saying, that's what I'm asking you. Is it the fact that it's somebody that you knew? Because I'm saying, we all seeing it now. Like, everywhere you look on social media, everybody blowing up, everybody showing that. Yeah. So it's not an issue of not seeing it.
Right.
It's me seeing it. It's me seeing you do it. And I know my man. I know exactly where he grew up. I knew.
Right.
Oh, like that. Yeah, I think that's the part that, you know what I'm saying?
Thank you.
And that's the big thing. I think that, you know, when you see someone, and I think that's why you have to be grateful for a person to allowing you into their circle.
Yes.
Because, see, and I think people be looking for the fact, like, okay, man, E allowed me into his circle. Man, E need to give me money. Why he ain't giving? He got all this money. He ain't giving. He ain't sharing nothing with me. But they don't realize, though, by E allowing you in his circle, you're getting an exposure that 99% ain't going to get.
You're watching how Olympians work. Close up. You know how powerful that is to watch how an Olympian works.
I'm going back, and you said it yesterday. Like, we got TGIMs next to pyramids. And I remember we went and E spoke to 10,000 people, and E can say, he can care less about that. E was like, we got to go do a TGIM because I need the kids in Detroit to be able to see me in front of the pyramids. Yeah. I remember that exact conversation, and that's what you... That's exactly what he's been doing. Like, I'm going to let y'all see somebody that you know do it so I can take all the excuses out. It's real. Yeah. It could happen. You know what I'm saying?
Did it hurt, though? Did it hurt?
Did it hurt? I'm trying to put It's the podcast, bro. On the podcast, we get real answers. And so I don't want to be quick with it
because
this was 20 years ago.
That's why I asked you if it hurt.
When I'm putting
Not hate. Did it hurt?
What hurt it was not
hurt
the... What hurt? What hurt it was not the fact of what he had.
Right.
What hurt it was the fact that I didn't have
That's
it.
Right. Yeah. What you knew you were supposed to have.
What else hurt it was the fact of, and this was the thing I think that hit me the most, was seeing what he was doing for complete strangers.
Right.
The women he was dating.
Yeah, dating.
And I couldn't even do 10% of that for the woman I was married to.
That's the thing that hurt
me. We was living from check, from her check to her check.
Oh, man. And that was real. I was taking one of my wife's checks.
I know what I was doing with Didi.
Oh, bro, we was
I'm
in there together.
I'm not talking about you.
And I think as a man, that hurt it because my heart was pure. I wanted to do, but I just didn't have the means to do it.
Yeah.
That's something when you really want to do, but you don't have the means to do it. And you're not in a position to do it. You go to school, you graduate, and here it is. This is reality now. Yeah. Yeah. And then because my parents were all police officers, I could almost see my life for the next 30, 40 years out.
Yeah.
And if I stayed in that, position, I can see that we was gonna have a good life, but this is the max that it was gonna be. Yeah, we would never have what I just saw.
Yeah.
That was the thing. We would never have it. Yeah. Never have it. It was impossible to have it.
Yeah, let's slow it down though, Maul. You said it. Let's slow it down. And this is why, this the burden. Like, yo, you just said it, bro. Like, yo, I don't have a burden of trying to be God for people. Like, I tell my saints, I tell everybody that I'm close to. Yeah. Like, yo, I'm not the one. That's the burden, though. You just answered it for me. So for all my, you know, my loved ones that's listening, you know what I'm saying? And that don't just mean blood or church members, just the people who feel like they rocking with me and following me. You said it, Maul. Don't look for the stuff. Like, literally sit down and go back through, as C always say, reverse engineer what we did. Because I'm thinking there are people who think, yo, if you give me $50,000 or if you give me $100,000, you put me on. But really getting put on is not getting money. Really what's getting put on is getting the system.
Yes.
Like, because once you know the system, you can, like, you looking at the people in this room, bro, like, we didn't grow up with stuff. Bump the money, the influence we have, the impact that we have. You know what I'm saying? It's like we go through the mall or we go through the airport, people know who we are. Like, it's real. So I'm
we in Europe.
Mall daughter talking about how she felt having her father eat and somebody knew who he was.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm just saying, though, I'm talking to my loved ones now that's listening to the podcast. Yeah. I'm talking to people that I love. Mm-hmm. You just got the answer. The answer is not coming around. The answer is not being around the environment.
Yeah.
The answer is actually finding out what were the steps. Mm-hmm. Like, that's what you should be, like, geeked about. Like, I had somebody say to me once, you know, because my wife, bro, you know, her mom needed a car. My wife, let's get my mom a car, whatever. I got you. Her mom looked out for us, whatever, even if she did. That's blood, right? But I had somebody else, Tiff, say to me that they wanted a car. And I was like, yo, what you don't want is somebody to buy you a car. Like, what you really want is to learn what people are doing to be able to generate money where they can buy any car they want whenever they want to buy it. You feel me? So to all my loved ones out there, Maul said it. Shift your thinking. Don't go, how can we blow up? Like, how can we get money? No. What is the process of becoming wealthy? Like, what's step one? What's step two? What's step three? What's step four? And the first step, you said it. What do you want your life to look like?
Yeah.
What do you want? Yeah. And then find somebody who has that life and start finding out what's their routine. When they wake up in the morning, what are they doing? What are their mindset? How are they spending their money? How are they spending their time? Because we human. If another human does it, it means that we're capable of doing it. You understand what I'm saying? So to your point as an Olympian, and please, y'all do your homework. Nobody could compete with American track and field. We was killing the game. Nobody could compete with us. FloJo. You had, give me my man's name, Carl Lewis. But what was the other dude?
Michael Johnson.
He had the gold shoes. You could not compete with us. But when Usain Bolt came on the scene, what he did was not just win individually, but now what happens is the men in Jamaica are starting to practice with him. So as they begin to practice with the number one runner in the world, now all of a sudden the Jamaican racers, men, are on a whole other level. Now they starting to compete with the American men and beating us. And more importantly, the Jamaican women start practicing with Usain Bolt. So the Jamaican women start beating the United States of America. So now Jamaica is dominant in track and field because of one man.
Yep.
And instead of them going, oh, we got the number one track star in the world,
They didn't go, we want to be around him. They went, we want to start practicing with him. We want to be in his circle. We want to see what he's doing. How is he doing it? What is he wearing? What is he eating? And one man took the entire country's track and field to a whole nother level. So I'm saying we got to stop being around people who are doing good in our community and making them like, you know,
sucking the life out of them.
Right. Or even like,
or making them a guy.
Yeah, even make, like putting them on a pedestal. Like, yeah, respect us.
Cheering for them.
Right. Don't cheer for us.
Right.
Practice with us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Don't cheer for us. Right. Trap. Like, can I tell y'all the one thing about London that blew my mind? I was like, yo, I've been to London before. This ain't my first time, bro. I started coming to London when I was in my 20s. Manchester was the first place I went to. When I came this time, what blew my mind was, yo, the whole crew here. I was like, what level we on? We got the video, all the video, not one of the video. I'm like, all of them came? The whole squad? Like, all three? Like, what kind of money? What we doing? I'm like, yo, we doing a podcast. Everybody's here. And that's what blew my mind. I got my mama, her son. I'm like, you got your son in London? Your husband? I'm like, what are we doing that we're no longer traveling with just send E? Because remember, you said it. You couldn't go to Egypt. It was like, all right, I'm going to send.
Either or.
It was like, either me and Candace got to go or Carlin. Tamisha got to go. Now, everybody, and then I ain't trying to put nobody business on the street, but we did Saturday. Folks was here way before Saturday. Folks landed in this joke on Tuesday. People came in on Wednesday. They like, when you leaving? I'm like, I'm leaving today. They like, oh, I ain't leaving the Tuesday. I'm like, yo, we are finally starting to create our community.
Yeah.
Whereas in other communities, yeah, they all travel together. Yeah, they all, because they, and it's like, yo, so for those of you who are following us, don't sit there in amazement and go, oh, look at Maul. Yep. Maul got an 18,000 square feet. He got a pool with kids in private school. Yep. Oh, we know Maul. You know how people do. Like, we know. Yep. We taking pictures. Oh, we know Maul. I saw people yesterday taking pictures of me. I'm like, why are you taking a picture of me? Like, we're not even together. One dude sneaking. Another person got their phone stuck. I'm like, why are you sneaking taking a picture of me? I'm human just like you human. What are you doing? Like, you should be taking a picture of yourself. Mm. You should take the camera on you.
Yeah, for the record, don't do that. Now, if you want to take a picture with me, I'm like,
right.
I told my man, shout out to my man, he probably listening, but it was in the hotel. Good. He's like, let's take a picture. I was like, oh, okay. I was like waiting for the call. He was like, yo.
Right. Don't do that.
But yeah, no, your point is well taken. You know, it, obviously, you know, if you teach a man to fish, you know what I mean? You're kind of on that.
But I'm just saying, I don't have people in my family, sometimes not even at the church, who will come to me and say to me, look, I don't want to say this on the podcast, but it seems like the closer people are to me, the worse they do. And the people who are far from me blowing up. Mm. I'm just being real. It just seems like people who don't know me like that.
Right.
I'm just saying, it seems like those people are learning. Yeah. They're on the podcast. It seems like people who closest to me is just like, oh, that's E.T. And so because they know me, they not getting the principles.
A prophet is not recognized.
I'm just saying. And I'm not even saying like for me.
Yeah.
Like, I don't even need you to pump me up.
Yeah.
But it seems like the people who are farthest from me are like, okay, what is E doing? And it seems like the people that's closest to me, they not taking the information. It's like, yo, you with me. Why would you be with me like this? And we had a function or wherever we are, you've never sat down and said to me, yo, E, how'd you get here?
Yeah, but I had a strong conversation with my friends.
But they listen to
and my family.
They are.
Yeah, I had a strong conversation with my friends and my family, and I sat each and every one of them down. I had to tell some of them, you got a lot of pride in you.
Yeah.
And if you don't get rid of that pride, you're going to have to get out of my life soon. Because it doesn't make any logical sense that you can be around me and I'm helping literally millions of people all over the world and you are not taking advantage of the information that I have to get rich
right,
off of that.
Right.
So I think a conversation is necessary. And when I had hard conversations,
Amen.
They started to change how they
Amen.
Were. I had a hard conversation with my daughter.
Amen.
I was like, it's no way in the world you live in a house with me.
That's it.
And you have not said, hey, I want to start this business. I want to start
That's
doing
it.
This. And you want to, it's no yeah, way in
no
the world because I can't feed
no,
it to
no,
you.
No way.
Yeah, it's no way.
What's the gap though? Like, and I'm just trying to figure it out why.
Well, it's familiarity.
Yeah.
It's familiarity. It's also comfortability. Mm-hmm. So like he said, we can ride your coattail to the top. We don't have to work to the top ourselves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. What was I saying?
You got to ride the top yourself. Familiarity. I'm right there.
It's familiarity. It's riding the coattail to the top, but it's also a lot of pride. Like, I don't want to ask for help. I can do it on my own. I don't want to ask you for help.
No, you do want to ask for help.
I'm asking everybody for help.
No, you do want to ask for help.
But it's humility to ask for help.
Yeah, but you do want to ask for help.
It's humility to ask
for
help.
But you don't want to ask for the principles.
Okay, that's it. That's right.
You don't want to ask for the principles. You want to ask for the money.
And you don't want to put in the work, man.
Yeah.
And that's not even called it a handout, though. Don't call it a handout. Because some people do get money from you. And I had some young ladies who ran a business. And they would call me and D and be like, yo, can we borrow 10 grand to get to next month? We give them the 10, they give it back. Mm-hmm. I ain't tripping. Like, they kept giving the money back. They would never taking it and not giving it back. But they never came and said, how is it that y'all don't have to borrow money from people? They never asked me that question.
Maybe they never knew the question had to be asked.
Okay, I'm just saying, if you got to keep getting money, you should know the question.
Back to my point, though. Yeah. It's like, if you teach a man to fish, you know, he'll eat the rest of his life. You give him a fish, he'll eat for a day, right? But the crazy thing about the person who either getting the fish or learning, it's the difference between somebody just handing me a fish and being like, yo, here you go. I don't have to do nothing. Mm-hmm. It's like, if I teach you how, there's still some other things you have to implement in order to do that. Let's say the fish really bite early in the morning. You still may have to get up at 5 a.m.
Before that, right. You got
to
get equipment.
You see what I'm saying?
Before that, you got to get equipment.
You got to get equipment. Yeah. You got to get out there at 5 a.m. You may have to be patient. You might not get a bite for 3 hours. Those are the things that they don't tell you. Those are the invisible intangibles that Maul had to put in. So he could teach you real estate, but can he teach you how to be diligent in looking at your first property? Can he teach you how to go to the bank and make sure you set up all your stuff properly? Right. So you see what I'm saying?
Well, that's on the program.
But I'm saying, those things, to your point, those things require effort and execution as well. Yeah. And people are always, what do? In life, we're trained to look for the shortcut.
Sure, absolutely.
And so if somebody continues to hand you a fish, it sounds romantic to say, go ahead and teach me, or I could just sit there and let you continue to feed me. You know what I mean? And that was something that, a concept that I didn't understand, and I didn't realize that, oh, they'll show up every single day for that fish.
Right.
Like, because that requires no effort.
Right.
There's no effort required to be like, yo, let me hold a fish today. Cool. All right, here I come.
Right.
I come back. Boom. I go to my house. I'm done. There's effort that's required with, to your point, fishing, even if I show you, hey, this is how you bait the line, boom, you do this, I still can't sit out there with you for 6 hours while you try to catch the fish.
How many, I'm going to ask the room, right? Just to your point. See, how many properties, anybody in the room, did Jamal look at before he got his first property?
77.
Everybody in the room know. He said in every presentation.
Right.
So how do you miss that? Like, that's patience.
Yep.
How long it take to look at 77 properties?
Actually look at them. That was
like months. Go look at them. How months. Long? That's months.
That was months. Only months?
Months.
I thought that was years.
No.
I'm saying to the point, he said in every presentation, but to what you're saying, see, like, people, like, they gloss over that whole thing, like, Maul, I've been looking. We get it now with the course. Maul, I've been looking. It's been 3 weeks. And I ain't get this nothing.
They say, hey, Maul, you looked at 77 properties, man. I just got through looking at 60. And I'm like, hold on, bro. Your 60 properties is looking on the internet.
On the internet.
Right?
And you scroll.
You just scrolling through the thing.
Bam. The internet wasn't even around. It was around, but they didn't have the MLS. Like I look.
You've been on there for an hour and a half.
Inside of properties, 77 properties. And so, like you're saying, bro, it's just people don't want to put in that work,
I can give you 100, bro, because my mom, my mom from the shot, so she ain't soft-skinned. But my mom hit me up like, yo, you got me with Maul, but this ain't working. I was like, Ma, it ain't been 6 months, Ma. Well, I don't seem like I'm going to get a property. I'm like, what? It's been 6 months. If it takes you 2 years to get a property that you're going to be able to eat off of and give to my sisters and then to, you know, their kids, Ma, what? You know what I'm saying? And I'll never forget, she was super, like, rude. It's my mom, bro. My mom called me like seriously, like, was I wrong? Should I have not done this? Mm-hmm. And I'm like, Ma, it ain't even been years.
Right.
Like, what are you looking for in months? It's not even possible. And I just remember telling my mom, and I'm telling those of you who are listening, like, yo, you got to trust the process and stop rushing the process. Like, it is what it is. You can't have a child early, but it's going to be some consequences if you have a child in 6 months versus the 40 weeks. You know what I'm saying? It's like it's gonna be some consequences to that. So you're trying to have a preemie, mm-hmm. like you don't want a preemie in life, but you want a preemie in life. Like it don't work like that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I was just like, Mom, relax, Mom, just like chill. It's gonna be all right. I'm talking about literally. This is my mom. That's why I said some people you can't get rid of. Like this is my mom. It's my flesh and blood. Mm-hmm. And my mom is just like, yo, son, your father got MS. He can't work. Your sister's like, stuff ain't working out. Like, I'm trying my hardest. And I'm like, yo, Ma, relax. Ma got you. And I'll never forget, she called me geek because she got, you know, pre-approved for whatever, however much. And then she ended up getting a property. And she was just like, whew, okay, it did. Sorry, son. You know, and I was like, yeah, I was like, yo, Ma, I'm not tripping. You know what I'm saying? Why? Because I was geek that my mom literally was like, made that step. Yeah. Because my mom's older. So a lot of people not really making the step. Yeah. So my mom came to you and was willing to make the step of, let me get a property. Like, my mom saw it. Like, so if this is how they doing it, my mom was like, let me fill out the paperwork.
And that's so, man, that's so clutch, dog, because if it take 5-6 months to get it, and now you got it for the rest of your life, your kid's life, it's so hard for people to see that. And I guess it goes back to instant gratification versus delayed gratification. You know what I mean? Like, delayed gratification takes some maturity. It really does. Especially,
I was just saying, when you just said that, even when you look at when I went to my guy house over 20 years ago, mm-hmm. I just got my 18,000 square foot house like 4 or 5 years ago. Mm-hmm. Look at all of the time and discipline. Yeah. And dedication took to get to that point.
Absolutely.
To still bring about that vision that happened, I saw 20 years ago.
Absolutely.
And most people wouldn't even ever realize that dream because they will give up in the process. Mm-hmm. They would just walk away and say, man, it's too much. It ain't gonna never happen. Yeah. But nah, you gotta stick with it. Yeah.
I saw it in my mom. Like, I saw the literal fear. Like, yo, I didn't put my money in this. I'm doing it. Is this gonna work? You know what I'm saying? I just told my mom, like, Mom, you know who these people are. Mm-hmm. And that's what I'm trying to tell y'all. For those of you who are scared to go fish, look who went to fish before you. You feel what I'm saying? Like, look at the people who've gone before you. And it is, I don't know y'all story, but for me, the hardest transition. Right.
You've been with me the whole time.
I'm just saying.
I don't know y'all story.
I'm just saying, because I'll say
exactly
something.
Exactly sure how y'all got here.
I got to do that because I'll say something. See, be like, nah, he had my story. You know what I'm saying? So I got to go ahead and prep it that way so he don't, you know what I'm saying? But literally, the hardest part for me of success has been embracing it.
Yeah.
That's been the hardest part for me. Okay. The hardest part.
But a part of me feel like he don't want to embrace success.
Yeah.
That's why he running around the airport for $300 shirts.
No, for real. I'm just saying, like, that
5 days straight.
That divorcing myself from that Midwest grind.
Yeah.
You know, and feeling bad. I never forget, my pastor came to me when I was at Oakwood, and he was like, when you gonna finish? He was like, yo, it ain't even like you was taking classes. Like, when are you gonna finish? And I just was like, bro, I ain't gonna lie to you. I don't know nobody from my neighborhood that finished college and wasn't bougie. Like, I don't know nobody in my hood who actually got a degree, blew up, and came back and helped the hood. I don't know nobody. Everybody that blew up, they all abandoned us. And I don't want to be that dude. Yeah. Like, I don't want to be the dude. I'm not trying to be funny. I'm not saying there's nothing wrong with this. But when I grew up, you get the Gucci, the Louis, you get the belt, you get the shoes, you get the bag, you get the car. And again, no disrespect, but you get a different type of female. Like, you don't necessarily get the chick that we grew up with. Mm-hmm. You ain't getting the chick from the block. You know, what's his name? Kanye said, you know what Kanye said. Mm-hmm. You blow up, then you get, you know what I'm saying? Like, yo, it's real. And I was like, I never want to be that dude. And I'm going to tell y'all what I love about hanging with Maul, hanging with y'all, is having normal people blow up and still keep it normal. Mm-hmm. Like, for real, I just grew up like, yo, everybody that graduate, become a dentist, a doctor, whatever, they all bougie. Like, they all think they better than us. Like, they all look down on us. Like, and I don't want to be that guy. So if education pulls you away from, it makes you like, bro, I ain't trying to be funny. I remember when I was at Oakwood, bro, you can't talk without people correcting you. It's like every time you open your mouth, you don't use that verb or that subject. I'm like, yo, this is stressful. Like, success is stressful because where I come from, people ain't just checking you on every single thing. It's like educated people, just every single thing. When you open your mouth, like the way you dress, like every single thing. And I just was like, God, I just can't see myself being educated
and still being me and still being able to help. And seeing people like y'all is just like, yo, you don't have to go that route. You don't have to act like, Ma, you said it. You got you and your family doing it. But if, when I'm around you, though, I don't have to feel inferior. Like, you don't make me feel some type of way. And when I used to be around educated people, people with money, like, they make you feel some type of way. Mm-hmm. Like, you ain't me. You ain't got what I got. I'm smarter than you. You feel what I'm saying? Like, I'm the smartest. I'm this and I'm that. And I'm like, what? Like,
did they make you feel that way or did you feel that way?
No, I didn't feel that way, but they try to make me feel that way.
They try to big themselves up.
The degrees by hanging on the wall.
Well, he was in school for 12 years, so you got to just specify which era of the journey you
So it was a different level of antagonism throughout. So I'm just saying, even when I met people who had money, they carried themselves a certain way. I don't see people, and I'm not, no disrespect, but I don't see a lot of people who are where we are going back into schools. Like, I don't see the dudes that you they not going back in schools every day. They not here at the elementary, middle school. Like, they not going back to the hood. They not at the Boys and Girls Club. They're not, they make their money and they scatter. Like, they don't come back and show kids, yo, this is what it looked like. They don't let, like, I was at a school, I don't remember, y'all help, I think Tiff might know the name of it, but it was like an hour from Orlando. I just went there recently. It's about 1,000 kids.
I'm like, why would you know? Right. I'm sorry. So shout out to Tiff.
What's the name? Miss Herter School. Miss Herter School. Uh-huh. See, let me tell you what blew my mind more than anything. Bumped the school. The kids was like, he's here. I was like, what? They had signs up. Listen, they stood outside for 30 minutes. She said every car that would go by, they was like, is that him? Is that him? Is that him? Is that him? And then when I got there, No, she said, I didn't get there for like maybe 30, 40 minutes. I got there right at 10. She said, they start saying, I knew he wasn't coming. This was a setup. Why you set us up like this? Wow. I knew he wasn't coming. When I got on the property, them kids was like, he's here. I gave him a hug, they started crying. Now this ain't about me, Ma. Here's what it's about. When you blow up, it some kind of way it takes you further from where you came from.
This week's episode is brought to you by HelloFresh. Listen, you're in one of these three categories. Number one, you either watch people cook, and that's my polite way of saying you don't even know how to really boil water. Number two, you're the fast track. You're on the go. You got a lot going on, man, and you're eating out every single day. And then number three, you a beast in the kitchen, but from week to week, you just keep running out of stuff to cook. You find yourself cooking the same things over and over. Listen, no matter which category you find yourself in, HelloFresh is the solution for you. HelloFresh makes cooking delicious meals at home a reality, regardless of your comfort zone in the kitchen. Using pictured step-by-step recipe guides with pre-measured ingredients, you only have to think, guys. It's measured for you and they tell you step 1 through 6. You have everything you need to get a wow-worthy dinner on the table in just about 30 minutes. Get your time back, like all those grocery trips that you're doing. Like, you don't have to do that anymore. Like, they're sending everything, literally pre-packaged in bags, just right to your doorstep. And it's fresh. You don't have to worry about it being, like, it's sent with ice packs to keep everything nice and cool. And then, guys, every week, there's over 20 seasonal and chef-curated recipes that you can pick from. From the family recipes, to the calorie smart, to the vegetarian options. And then there's a fun menu series, like the Hall of Fame and Kraft Burgers. You have the flexibility of starting and stopping your deliveries to fit your lifestyle. Easily change your days, food preferences, and skip a week if you need to. This week, the family and I got three, man. We had the harissa sweet potato pockets, the trattoria veggie panini. See, I don't even know how to call half these names. And then yesterday, we had the salsa verde enchiladas. Listen to what I'm telling y'all. It took all about probably 30, 35 minutes to go, literally from opening the bags to us sitting down eating. If you heard of this one, you're better than me. The poblano peppers mixed with the chili peppers, man, they gave it a nice little kick. Not too hot, but like a nice savory flavor. Y'all think I'm playing. Y'all didn't even know what a poblano was. See what I'm saying? Go to HelloFresh.com/success10. That's the number 10. And enter the same code, success10, to get free 10 free meals. 10 free meals shipped to you. Again, that's HelloFresh.com/success10. And use that same promo code, success, the number 10.
You know what I'm saying? When you blow up, some kind of way, you don't give back. And how do you know you blew up? You know you blew up because you got a Rover. You know you blew up because you can wear fancy clothes.
You know how I blew up? My wife walked in and hit something off the mini bar last night. I ain't even tripped. She grabbed some Pringles. I ain't even trip. Normally I trip. Right. Normally I go crazy. Right.
What was the shift, see?
Oh, Pringles. The short stack.
I said, what was the shift, though?
I'll tell you what. I'm glad you asked.
You know what I'm saying? What was the shift? Why weren't you pissed this time?
I remember we saw Australia.
Left side, Maul.
I almost had to leave her in Australia last time we
were
there.
Oh, yeah, no, we was in Australia.
Oh,
Candace been on.
Let me say something.
Did he, mindset.
Hey, did he tell me? I don't know what happened, but somebody's room weren't ready, and Candace walked. There was a Twix sitting there. She was like, who? She didn't even look at the little note card that tell you it's $75 for this Twix. She just hit it. And she did it yesterday when we walked in the room. It was original Pringles sitting there.
Original.
And it was right on the top of the joint. And we walked in, she just, and I was like, my heart, I did kind of like, whoa, that was a little premature because you didn't look, at least look. But I didn't feel the same rage
that you would feel before. Right, in the past. No question.
So you buying Rovers, that's your key to success.
Yeah. My wife is buying Pringles.
And she going crazy at the mini bar, bro. What can I say? Let's all ball out.
Moving up.
All right, I want to change the topic a tad because I, you know, as I was preparing my notes for the podcast in the wee hours of the morning.
Show me notes.
Look at this. I really want to know, just so Tip can verify, what's that word?
Transformation.
Okay. I have, so maybe the three of us probably won't be as knowledgeable on this topic, but while I have two people who I think very, very highly of, and Tiff, we can maybe even get into your story a little bit more for the people who don't know exactly your background, where you come from, and the things you've accomplished in your life. And then, you know, obviously we know E and what he's been through in terms of transformation. And I think the hardest thing in the world for people to do is change. And when you think about it, like, you know, people just stuck in their ways. Like, it's hard to, like, get that true, like, breakthrough for people. Yeah. Like, you have somebody who insecure or whatever. You know what I mean? It's like you see them 10 years later and you like, yo, you still that. You know what I mean? And so while we have the two of you who went through incredible life transformations, and Tiff, I'll let you kind of, you know, start off and you can kind of give us the background of, you know, where you came from and how you were doing things. We obviously, those of us who have heard the keynote that you've been given on tour, every time, it's funny every time. I don't know why, Tiff.
Tiff. Just because of her dry humor.
Oh, yes.
Because of her dry humor.
Oh, no. Herself, yeah.
No. And the crazy thing is, I always love seeing Tiff speak because it takes the crowd a minute to be like, oh, okay, I get it. Right. Like, yeah. At first, it's like, okay, like, yeah, yeah.
It take her a minute, too.
Right.
Take her a minute, too.
But I do think while we have both of you, and you guys are thought leaders, and, I mean, Tiff has, you know, obviously thousands of people who tune in on a regular basis to hear what she has to say and help them get to the next level, and E, you as well. But I think just as unique, both of you, I don't want to say living two lives is different. You know, I don't know the exact wording for it. Because, again, I think with Carl, Maul, and I, we've all kind of been on this track of, like, you know, whatever. But both of you were in completely different lanes, maybe looking like your life was headed for, you know, complete disaster, maybe. Mm. And you were able to turn that around.
You know what I'm saying?
Well, he was headed for disaster.
You know what I'm saying?
He was headed for disaster.
I was a three and he made me a 10. You know what I'm saying?
No, I'm talking about...
Hey, Ma.
Yeah. I'm talking about trash can eat. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm talking about? Homeless eat. Not 12
trash
to get a 4.
Can we title this podcast Trash Can Eat?
Trash Can Eat. 12 to 4. 12 to 4 ratio.
Speaking of which, I had a fair file. And don't let me get off too far off topic, but he said that the homeless dude... He said, like, man, I don't have no cash. He was like, get a couple dollars. He was like, I don't have no cash. And my man was like, no, I got square.
Yeah.
Like, and he put the square on that square out. I was like,
bro, I don't know if I feel comfortable giving you my credit card information. No, this was back in the States.
Yeah.
Because you know me, I don't carry cash for real.
So you know, like, I don't carry cash. My man said,
I got square.
I got square.
I was like, ooh, I'm good.
The world changing, bro. That ain't my man.
Oh, I see y'all. I see some faces.
Look at Nick. sticky face.
That ain't five.
Hold on, I don't.
Oh, that's five.
Okay, okay. I'm just saying.
Hey, my man using all. It ain't five. My man using all his resources. What I'm saying.
He using all his resources.
The debit card Apple Pay game has messed up the hustle for those for the people who are using it as a hustle. So is that fair or foul, Tiff?
Oh. Man, it's fair and foul.
It's fair for him, foul for me.
Yeah.
It's fair for him.
Wow.
Didn't work though. I didn't pull up my card for him.
Because hey, don't that Square account got to be linked to a bank account?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, they got a bank account.
So my man got a bank account.
No question. No, everybody out there not. For some people, they working.
It's okay, does it change it if he said, y'all just shoot me a Cash App real quick? And then he's standing there waiting for it to hit his phone?
I would have done that.
You
don't need my... He was going to take my information with the Square board. Yeah, but give me your homeless doc, whatever it is. I got you. I got you, bro. I got you.
Hey, don't worry. He can say that because he was homeless.
Hello. He part of that ministry.
It's like being black and making a black joke.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? all right, back on track.
Come back.
Back on track.
It's too far. Always.
It's like 2:00 in the morning in the States. Yeah. So, all right. So I want to know about transformation. And Tiff, you can walk us through, you know, kind of your story, and then also like those moments you talked about. Obviously, the Oprah thing in terms of that, but just in life, for those of us, you know, who are listening that don't know your story, kind of talk us through how you were able to make such a dramatic shift.
Yeah.
Into this person that you are today, because again, I think that's the thing that's so hard for people is like, man, you grow up a certain way, your parents raise you a certain way, you get to be 30 years old or you get to be 25 years old and you got all of these beliefs and things about life, and it's hard for people to make that hard left.
Yeah. And I think one of the bad things to keep saying is how hard it is for people, because I think you're kind of indoctrinating people by making them think it's harder than it is, because it can be easy.
It's easy.
It is
easy. But the mindset is...
It's easy. Let's just go with that a little bit. But
I got you.
Yeah,
I got you.
Easy.
I got you.
Mall,
yeah, we want to help him out.
Yeah, Tamal's thing, when I was younger, like in elementary school, I always knew I was going to be rich and famous. And I used to sign my autograph. Wow. I used to practice it. I used to think I was going to be an actress. I thought that was my vehicle there.
I could see it.
Yeah. I was always signing my actress. I was always signing my signature. Right. You're kidding. But I was always practicing at home.
No,
I mean, I was always doing scenes of movies. Like, I was going to be big. I was going to be rich. I was going to be famous. And I kind of kept that mindset. And the vehicle when I was younger was drug dealers, right? If I wasn't going to be an actress, that was the rich people I saw in my neighborhood. That was it. You know what I'm saying?
So you were going to be one?
No, I wasn't going to be one, but that was the way I saw to get there.
Oh, yeah.
But I also saw, I had the luxury, and I call it a luxury, to see drug dealers die and go to jail.
Hmm.
And that benefited me because I always had a healthy fear of not going to jail and not want to lose my life over that. Because you got to understand, I saw people that was killing it selling drugs in the hood.
Killing
and then they would go to jail forever. And I would sit on my calculator in high school and do the math. I'm like, man, you could have worked at McDonald's forever.
Made more money.
But I was doing the math back then, right? Mm-hmm. So with that mindset, I'm like, okay, well, I know there's a way to make a million, but I don't know how to do it without drugs. And I'm not going to be a drug mule. And remember, I'm not going to be a hustler's wife because they go to jail too now.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Once you found out the RICO
Act,
you was like, wait a minute.
Oh, yeah. No. I can fight outside of jail.
I can go to jail for holding it down.
Yeah. I know that. No, I can't hold it down.
More time.
It's not going to work.
P.O.P.
But nobody I knew was entrepreneurs. So that was like a foreign concept where I was from.
Isn't that crazy?
Foreign. Completely foreign.
Oh, facts. Back you used to say that. People used to look at you like...
Yeah. But I was also in the thought process of, because I was always a creative. I didn't think analytically. My mind is not an analytical thinker. I don't have systems in place, but I am a creative. And the very first thing I was incredibly good at was nails. And so I got my nail license in New York State when I was 16 years old.
Wow.
Yeah, I won a competition. I was second in New York State competition for nails. I was really good at what I did.
They have competitions?
Yeah, apparently.
Wow.
Yeah, I was second place in New York State. I was great at whatever.
Was it a bedazzle?
Yeah,
I'm just saying, New York got a lot of people.
Walker's still there.
That's a lot, New York State.
What was the finishing move you had?
So the first one, you had to do acrylic, you had to do a silk wrap, you had to do gel, and I had to do two nail designs. So I had to show the smoothness, you had to show the curvature. It was like a situation.
Oh, yeah, she did.
Wow, I was saying you like the Usain Bolt of nails.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I got carpal tunnel. That's the only reason I stopped. Because it wasn't a time where they had the electric file, so I was still filing, and right here it would just burn like crazy, and I had to eventually stop. But I had my life figured out as a celebrity nail technician,
like a torn ACL for a basketball player.
I know it's the first time you heard this, but that was my vehicle that I found out, and I was the only one doing it in high school. So I used to skip class and do full sets and nail design in my study hall in lunchtime.
No, any teachers?
No. I won. Got 1.7 GPA.
So you was doing that. No, you had teachers on the side.
So we had four periods in school, in high school, right? Which means that our lunches were also 120 minutes.
Wow.
Yeah, we had a huge. Our high school was almost as big as a college. We could leave the campus as a high school. Like, we just had a lot of freedom. They shouldn't have gave high schools
in New York.
Yeah. Upstate, Rochester.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. So I would skip a 120 minute class. Because I'm doing 15 minute fills. They're like, I need a fill today. I got you.
What you charging?
English
thing. $15.
$15.
Ooh.
Okay. Oh, that's high back then.
$15.
That's the same age.
Yeah, 15
for a high school student.
15. So I'm making this money, but this start hurting. But that was the vehicle. So I always had the mindset of how can I make money doing this. You know, I'm from Rochester, New York, so it's a lot of snow. Mm-hmm. And when I was 10, I put together a team. I had a snow shoveling business. But I negotiated wrong. It was like, they were like, I'll pay you $10. It was like 20 of us. It took them like 5 hours.
You get 50 cents?
No, everybody quit on me. I had to go tell the person. I was like, everybody left. I don't have a business.
Oh, she got real entrepreneurship training.
No, I couldn't. The snow was like up to our neck. It was bad.
And you had carpal tunnel, so you couldn't quit.
It was carpal tunnel. 50 cent a person. It was like, I quit. Wow. But that was the vehicle I was taking, and obviously every year I came up with a better idea.
Right.
But that was essentially how I started. So the transformation for me was always kind of innate because I saw the money coming in, but I had to think that there was a better way for me because I was doing it legally. Because I always knew it was wrong to sell drugs, but that was the mindset I had. And as I got older, and this is another privilege, I was always around people that were making a lot of money legally. When I started getting into my teens and my 20s.
Wow.
And they took me in. Mm-hmm. And what was crazy about that, this is how you know, like, I had a lot of favor on my life even today, but they would take me in and people would be like, how you get close to them? They don't like anybody. And they would meet me and like, I'm taking you in. So everybody always saw something in me growing up. Yeah. That God like just made sure, like, I'm gonna make sure Tiff's safe in these areas. And I would watch. And I remember there was even this one time I was like in a business deal with somebody and somebody was like, you know, they're not giving you all your money. They're not being fair with you. And I said to them, I said, listen, I can. What I got to learn from this person is so much more important from what they're stealing from me right now.
Right, no question.
So I'm good with the thing.
But I had. Yeah. You got to understand that the person was brilliant. Mm-hmm. And I was like, the $10,000 that they probably owe me. Right. Like, I can't make if they give me the $10,000 and they cut me off. I can't learn what I need to learn and I knew this in my 20s, in my early 20s. I always had this mindset.
Who was stealing? What was their name?
I ain't know. They might be watching. They might be watching. But I always had the mindset that, so when I look at my life and I look at how young I was with the mentality I had, there was something innate in me that other people around me didn't have that maybe even say, who wouldn't take $10,000 at 20 as a teen mom?
Right.
Instead of saying, nah, they got something I need to learn and I can only learn it if I'm around them and I can only watch what they doing, because while a little of them might be bad, there's a lot of them that's good.
Absolutely.
And I'm not gonna stay around them, but they got some type of character that I need right now. Yeah. And it was just, who thinks of that? So the transformation for me wasn't it was more my mind was already there. My body just had to catch up to where my mind was.
Meaning,
I was already wealthy. I was already rich and famous. Mm-hmm. I was already there. So, you know, there's this thing where people say, make sure you know who you are before you get famous or it's going to kill you. Mm. Like, fame is like heroin. You get addicted to it. You can, like, crash. You get over. Like, it's just a bad thing. You see people go crazy, right? I already knew who I was before I got famous because I was always preparing to be there. There was never a doubt in my mind that I wasn't going to be well known. I wanted to make sure, even when I was younger, how can I sustain this with good character? That was always important to me.
Absolutely.
And good intent. How can I not lose it? How can I not steer people the wrong way with influence? how when I get it and people listen to my voice, I can make sure.
You think everybody has a moment or moments where they have that particular opportunity? Because we sit here and talk about how everybody has these choices and things like that. But I just heard you say it was innate. And I heard you say people who never take people in took me in and showed me.
They did.
So what if I'm the person who is not innate? And that person told me to get the heck out their face.
But a lot somebody of people to them was takers.
That's what I'm asking.
You're talking about the people around them. They were driving Bentleys and Phantoms, right? I was around, like, okay, so let's say they took me in, right? But one of my biggest advantages is that people have always underestimated me. So I had the advantage of being underestimated, which means people would say things around me that just shouldn't have been said, right? Mm-hmm. So let's say their old friends were around and their old friends started saying, oh, they got them another car. Like, why would they get another car? And I would say, well, it's their money. Why wouldn't they get another car? Should they get you a car?
Right.
So the reason I started to understand why they took me in, because when they got a car and I was like, oh, man, they would call me and say, we just got a new car, but they wouldn't call them.
Right.
And why did they call me? Because I was celebrating. I was excited. Right. I was like, we got a new car. Because right. I'm driving the car.
You know, that's big.
But they always called me. And
because you
one
can't
of them,
call people.
Right. When the wife would get a $5,000 purse, she would call me.
Right.
And I would go to her house and I'd be like, she is so pretty. And we would celebrate the purse. But somebody else would say, you got a new purse.
Catch
what
that.
You doing
you
with
listen
their money?
To the podcast. Yeah. Catch that.
Yeah. And I was young when I was doing that, but I never thought that I couldn't have it. I was like, ma'am, one day I'm going to fly you to London. We always said that. I was like, one day I'm going to get a flight.
Because you're around it.
Oh, yeah.
So it's only a matter of time if you're around it that it's going to be yours.
That's right. That's right. So, and everybody else around them was takers. So that's why I think they took me up under their wing, because they saw my potential.
Yeah.
They saw my willingness. And like I said about mentorship, a lot of people are like, can you mentor me? Can you mentor me? And nobody wanted me to dead weight. And I wasn't dead weight. I was already putting in the work. I was already out there hustling and grinding, and they was like, she has something special in her and she's not taking. If we mold her
so
up
you put
now,
yourself in a position for people to want to.
Yeah, but not I didn't do it to make people to want me, not that you're saying that, but I just want to, you don't put yourself in a position to make people want you. I put myself in a position because I always knew I had the power to do that. Mm-hmm. And then when they saw I put myself in a position, they said, let me take you up under my wing because I want to do my best to at least groom you, if you will.
That's
thankfully
good.
I had healthy groomers. Because some people groom you for bad things.
Yeah.
But they said, let me groom you. And sometimes they did say something that was bad, but I had an inner system, Holy Spirit, that was like, no, that's not right. Like, maybe the husband would say, all men cheat.
Yeah.
So I had to kind of say in my mind, that's not true. Because he was grooming me to say, you know, to stop letting those men go, all men cheat. So just find one that's going to cheat a little less. Mm-hmm. And that was all I had ever seen was men cheating.
Yeah.
So I was like, that can't be true. I can't assume that all men cheat or it's going to ruin me. So certain things, obviously, I was groomed for bad, but also there was so much more good in that. So the transformation, again, for me was more physical, getting to that place I saw in my mind, than it was mental. So by the time I got the money and got all the like success, if you will, I was already like, oh, I've already been here. Mm-hmm. So I wasn't excited about
that's
it
big.
Anymore.
And that's key.
You know what's funny? What
I was like, finally.
Yeah.
But I didn't celebrate it because I had already celebrated it when I was in high school.
How old were you?
I was like 30.
You was 30 years old.
Yeah.
I just want people to hear it because, and I had this problem with my son. He is where you are.
Yeah.
Like he always been on that. You know, like since he was younger, we got a guy at our church, Chuck Arrington. And my son and Chuck have always been close. Because Jay, like, wants the finer things in life.
Yeah.
But I always struggle. Right. Well, not to him, he don't. I promise he don't. Which is crazy because you look at your life, what's normal to you, and you look at another person's life, and what's normal to them. But I always say to Jay, it's nothing wrong. Because, like, Dad, you trying to... I'm like, no, it's nothing wrong with what you want. I just think you moving... Like, you want it at 24.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You feel what I'm saying? It's like, maybe it might take you... till you 29 or to 30. So that I only ask you that because people are listening, may not know how old you were when you got it. Mm-hmm. To Maul's point, yeah, I got an 18,000, but I didn't get that 20 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
You feel me? So I just wanted them to hear, even though you knew it and you could touch it and taste it and smell it, it still took you till you was 30 years old.
Yeah.
The way I look at it is like at that young age, like even with Jay, I talked to Jalen the other day and I'm like, bruh, you're planting seeds today.
Right. Yep.
that crop is going to come about maybe when you turn 29 or 30.
Bro, I think so, you already got it, but personally.
So when you're planting seeds, you know, don't get weary. Don't no farmer plants a seed saying, oh, man, I want the crop today.
I think people should go through farming school.
Yeah, they should.
Because I don't think people have a realistic view of what it looks like to plant a seed. Because we heard this term before, but I was an overnight 10-year success. Like, I grinded for 10 years before anybody knew my name, before I was, like, putting in work. Like, who else? When they were, people are like, I got a job. I'm being paid $20 an hour. And I was like, oh, I could sell 2 books in an hour. So let me just sell 4 books and 5 books in an hour. That was my mindset. Yeah. Like, I'm not going to work for $20 an hour. I'm going to sell 4 books in an hour, and I'm going to make that money. But I was an overnight success, but it took me 10 years to get there.
Now, isn't it amazing how a person will, they don't want to plant seeds in their own life and wait 10 years to get that crop.
But yet
they will work a job for 30 years and wait to get promoted 20 years working that job.
Because of the security.
And that's crazy, though.
But it's not because they plan on your need to be secure.
Yeah.
So they plan on that. They know that you want to feel secure. So they make you feel like, well, maybe you don't have the money, but you do have the security. And for a lot of humans, the security is better
than
the
question. Like Kodak and Xerox was in Rochester, New York. Kodak was huge. And everybody's mom and dad worked at Kodak. Absolutely. You know what I'm saying? And that was job security. And then one day they couldn't keep up with the digital cameras and everybody moving up to more online.
Not they couldn't keep up. They decided not to.
Yeah, that's insane.
Yeah, they just was like, we're not going there.
Yeah, and it wrecked everything, but the security fell down with the change. Nobody transformed with time. And so when I think of transformation also, now that I just think of that, I'm able to adapt to what's new and what's going on. And I'm not a blockbuster. I'm like, okay, this is shifting. I can get in something when it's first hot, and then I can kind of sense where the season is changing to something else, and I can get there before the world gets there, so I can already start there.
You get your Square card reader and make sure you're good.
Not homeless.
I'm not homeless.
I think it's important to point out too, though, Tiff, that even though you had this laid out and you had like, okay, this is how it's going to be, you also had obstacles and things that happened along the way. You got pregnant.
Right.
Right? And so talk about that in terms of, whoa, this wasn't exactly what I was planning on.
If I didn't have my daughter, I wouldn't have been this person. Like, if I didn't have my daughter, put a lot of guards up for me. So, for instance, I used to fight heavy, like, try to take you off this earth, like, die. Yeah, it was insane. Get off this earth. They didn't call me Tyson Tip or nothing.
That's right. Don't let the frame. Fool them heads. She got them heads.
Everybody. But that was it. I was underestimated. I never lost one.
Undefeated. You must have been picking up bricks as him.
My brothers taught me how to fight. Yeah, I didn't fight like a girl. I fought like a boxer. Yeah. It was nice, okay? It was nice. But what I'm saying is...
Well, Tyson was trained in Rochester, I think. So
was he probably?
You know what I'm saying?
But when I was fighting and I had my daughter, I kind of slowed down. I didn't slow down for about till she was about 10.
Well, she made it seem like she was having sanctioned bouts. You know what I'm saying? She like, I gotta slow down.
So I
was only booking them once every month. You know what I'm saying?
It's true.
Line up and put your ace whooped.
No, but it was the kind.
Hey, he makes me.
Don't do it. Right here,
but he kind of whipped
me. No, listen.
We want to hear about his hand. Bop.
He didn't took it.
Okay.
I'm walking past somebody and the person look at me up and down. I'm small. Rochester, New York back then was known as the murder capital of New York.
Right.
Okay. So you talking about murder capital over Brooklyn, Rochester, New York was the murder capital. People came from the city of Rochester.
Now that we're talking about fighting, I kind of hear your New York accent coming out a little bit. I'm like, okay, it's more believable.
Right.
They didn't come back.
It was a murder capital. My mother's favorite student, her name was Stephanie Givens, died. An 11-year-old girl stabbed her in her main artery on a school bus over a boy, and she was 12 years old. Wow. And my mother had to perform CPR on her and try to save her life. They won't plane up in Rochester.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you die.
But let him know.
Yeah. So it was more so for... self-preservation because... Yeah. Because I was tiny, I was an easy target.
Yeah.
But if I hit you first in front of everybody with the strength that my brothers taught me, you at least fell to your knees with that first punch.
Yeah.
I came around with the second punch and then kicked you. you're not getting back up. Because I had a certain strength. Yeah. I don't, you know.
Yeah.
So you could have looked at me and just been like, I would be like, hey, because I was always goofy and nice, but I would have been like, hey, and if you looked at me up and down, I hit you.
Quick.
On sight.
Right there.
Yeah. Like, you not finna disrespect me.
How old was you when you was doing that?
Oh, like 15, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 10, 15,
10, 30, 45, 47.
Yeah.
45, 47. I'm glad I was smiling.
I mean, it was so bad. My mother would be like, yo, if I got beef with this girl, I'll give you $20. I'm like, where she at? Where's my money?
Yeah, let me get that money first, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't play any games. It was a situation. Oh yeah,
first
like when I say,
when I
threw away my knife and everything, like I had to throw away my, my dad would never let me get a gun. Like I would have been in jail forever.
Wow.
Like I had that kind of
anger,
like, oh, it was
rage.
Incredible. It was rage.
Rage.
Oh, I had a rage. It, the strength that I had
now I'm
came with
that
the
anger
rage.
Management they made you take.
Oh, it was no, I needed it.
You did. Cool. She did. She
oh yeah,
said she
I was
did.
Killing people in school. Yeah, that's why he said my principal said I can't let you walk
bodies?
The stage. No, I don't, I ain't killed nobody in real life. My principal said, just put that out there. My principal said, I can't let you walk this stage unless I've done everything I can to make sure you're productive. He said that because I was taking people's heads and pushing them in the lockers.
Wow.
But a lot of that was also, like, I didn't like bullies. Like, people would come to me and say, Tiff, she's picking. I went to, like, an all-white school. I had a lot of friends. I was very popular. So people would be like, Tiff, she's picking. Yeah, she was like, Tiff, she's picking on me. And I'm like, who
they
picking on
me? They was scared of you.
Exactly.
Vote for Tiff.
You was the bully.
Who's picking on you? And they would be like, they said, I mean, but it was people that they knew they couldn't fight. It was like other kids that knew that they were easy targets. And I'm like, man, they know you can't. What time?
Yeah.
They like 12 o'clock. I'm like, I'll meet you at the locker. And they came to them and I'm like, what's up? Like, you're not finna.
The champion.
Real quick.
The people's champion.
Remember?
The people's champion.
I fight bullies. But yeah, it was a situation. So my daughter, and I stopped fighting maybe after she was like 10, but my daughter was a really big, like,
what year is it? She just turned?
Yeah, she just turned 20.
14.
10 years.
Just started fighting 4 years ago.
Yeah. But it was a rage I had.
So you retired undefeated, huh?
Oh, undefeated. Yeah. It was a rage I had that I had to stop. Maybe. My last fight, I was 4 months pregnant with my son.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. It was incredible.
And you won that one?
Yeah. I was in the Ruth Chris Steakhouse.
Oh. Fighting Ruth Chris?
Yeah.
I'm thinking McDonald's, Arby's.
What was the catalyst for this one?
No, rage. I already know where she at.
Was
when you got rage.
See, now look, they talked about me. Now look, everybody went, what happened?
What happened?
And no, rage.
Yeah. Rage. His dad had a girlfriend that nobody knew about.
Yeah.
Say
no
rage.
More. Say no more.
Here come Debo. Everybody tucking their chain and they tipping people around. Hey, Tip. But no, I think, again, though, for you know, those of us who have not undergone such a transformation, I think it's always fascinating to hear about, like, how you can be. And not only that, obviously, you started your career by writing,
fiction. Urban hood fiction.
Right. That was what you did. And now compared to what you do now. So even after you let the rage go, there were other things in your life where you completely...
Well, let me tell
change
you when
courses.
I when I was writing my hood fiction, because I got into that.
Is that a thing?
Yeah.
So they may not know.
Yeah, I didn't know it was a job.
No, they may not know. You,
she made up.
She was a 7-time bestseller.
Essence magazine bestselling author, including the number one spot.
Under hood fiction.
Under hood, it was hood fiction. It was urban literature.
Urban
literature. How old are you at this point? When you the first one?
Urban literature. In 20s. Yeah, urban literature.
And never had a course on writing a book, never anything. Wrote your first book and was a bestseller.
Couldn't be that hard. Ended up not being that hard. That's why I keep telling myself.
Well, Lord knows you had stories to tell.
But I also had stories to tell from the other crazy people around me. Because, again, Rochester was Rochester. So you're talking about, like, I had a plethora of stories.
Right.
And I remember writing my last fiction novel. And I tried, because I was always good with English and the Queen's English and, you know, hello. That was an awful rendition.
That's okay.
But thank you. Yeah. And I remember I put a big word in there. And the editor at the time said, oh, your audience doesn't understand that word. You have to talk hood. And I said, oh, I'm done then. That was the last book I wrote. Because if I'm working with an audience that I have to dumb myself down for, and they can't go with a simple word like expeditiously that I learned in the seventh grade, then this isn't the genre for me.
You was watching Lean On Me?
Joe Clark.
Yeah.
That's where I learned. Everybody learned
expeditiously.
Yeah, everybody learned that from Lean On Me.
You can't do expeditiously. So that was a transformation for me because I'm not going to dumb myself down. Mm-hmm. And I also understood that me dumbing myself down was going to keep me in a certain level. And I said, well, I've already capped. I don't want to be an Essence Magazine bestseller anymore. Like, I'm bored now. Mm-hmm. So if I have to keep this language going to stay here, I'm moving on. That was the last book I ever wrote, just because that was said.
And I guess, okay, so then not even just the transformation in terms of not being an author to author, but then now the transformation into the type of leader that you are today, where, you know, women obviously follow you for, you know, your spiritual connection with God and, you know, your ability to lead them. When did that come about and kind of how did we get from writing? What was the name of your first book?
Millionaire Mistress. Oh, my God. People always think I was a mistress. I wasn't a mistress.
What does that mean?
Millionaire mistress?
Yeah.
A mistress is a woman that sleeps with married men. I was never a mistress.
Okay.
It was just, I wrote the book, and the book didn't have a title.
So you gave it?
Somebody else found the title, and alliteration sell well, meaning MM, millionaire mistress. So, so we just went
Secret
with that title.
Success.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Yeah, alliteration sell well. But the great thing is, I think a lot of people, when they think about transformation, they want to change who they are. Right. So I took the fight I had and I just took it to God's side. So what God did with the fight was he purified it. Mm-hmm. He crucified it and cleaned it off and then said, you can work with the fight over here, but I don't work with a certain fight. So I take that same fight and I teach entrepreneurs how to be bolder in God, mm-hmm. because a lot of people lack boldness. They're passive. They're afraid. They're fearful. They don't want to use their voice. And who going to beat you? Like, you say that, who's going to fight you? You know what I'm saying? So that's kind of what I bring to the conversation of entrepreneurship, is the boldness in teaching entrepreneurs how to grow boldly in God in that way. But I didn't kill that. A lot of people, like, they try to take where they were in their old life and they say, well, I'm not like that. And they become extremely passive because they're almost afraid of that rage that they had. And they're like, if I don't keep it under rocks, I'm going to kill everybody. But the truth is, because it's so crucified, and because it's so purified, I only take it and I have the righteous indignation of God towards things that God hates. And I bring that same wrath. I always say, I'm a friend to anybody that is a friend of God, and I'm an enemy to anybody who not. Like, I'm the last person on earth you want to mess with, because I might not fight you no more, but I know how to pray. And I don't give God no rest.
So you get it. Yeah.
I will not sleep. I pace back and forth in prayer. You can't outpray me. Maybe he can, but not really.
Yeah. I was going to say, you want to talk about a meeting of two undefeated.
Hey, I'm going to bed early. I don't know if I stay up late.
But I take that same strength. I take that same aggression. I take that same, and I give that to God. And it just, you know what I'm saying? So all of that is, that's a transformation I had. I took the same person I was, crucified it, and then I allowed I use it for good now. I use my powers for good.
God.
Amazing.
For God. I use my powers for God.
And we are so happy that you're using them powers for God.
I know that's right.
And not to knock people out in the streets
and
of Rochester.
Names and people's faces.
No, she didn't actually do that.
She saw snapped and unsnapped.
Oh, yeah.
Because she was about to snap.
But he got into a fight at a basketball game one time. Since we're talking about fight stories. No, he got to scrapping at a hoop game one time. You know what I'm saying? With Pojo. Who the...
Tom Bojo. You about to make some stuff up.
No, what was his name?
I don't know. Everybody listening to the podcast.
Ricky Earl.
I don't know. Everybody listening in now. I don't know.
Y'all went to the game, remember?
I don't. I do not remember that. I'm born again.
Tell us about your fighting days in Barbados.
Oh, yeah, no, I had no fights. I had an older brother. I had no fights at all. Like, to Tiffany's point, I was young and I was small. I was always a year ahead. So my parents started me school early because both my parents were teachers and, like, we about to pay daycare, so you come to school with us.
I know that's right.
So I started school early, so I was always a small kid in the class.
So you started at what, three?
I started at three. So most people look out for the baby, you know what I'm saying? So I grew up as the baby in the class, but, like, I knew how to, like, you connect with everybody. Yeah. So my friends was always the bullies. So I'd hang out with them. So anybody mess with me at all, like, I just had to throw, the first punch and get out the way. That was it. So I literally, like, man, you ain't gonna mess with me. And then I was like, all right, boom. And it was over.
But listen, when you talk about the impact of my transformation, all my friends came with me. And the ones that couldn't dropped off. So you're talking about Like, my best friend had her first baby at 12, had her second baby at 14, had her third baby at 16. And when she saw me changing my life, she was like, oh, either you're going to leave or I have to change too. And then everybody started to say the same thing, like, oh, we have to catch up or we have to transform. So it wasn't even just a mental or a financial transformation with the people in my circle. People literally changed their lives, like their soul started to change, their minds and their emotions started to change. But I was a catalyst of that, and I didn't put ultimatums on the table, but they saw how I was moving, and I couldn't stay with somebody who still was, I would say, you need to go to therapy.
Yeah.
Like, you can't come around me no more. You need help. I can't help you because I'm too harsh, and I will kill you with my advice when you probably need something a little softer because I don't know what it's like to be raped at 8.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? No, I can say, get over it, but I've never been there. I can't tell you that. Because you've never dealt with that. You got to go to therapy. So I would have these hard conversations with my friends. And I would say, listen, if you don't... I told another friend, your son is your boyfriend. Like, that's the thing with some women.
Oh, no question.
That they start to date their son and don't want him to be with anybody else. And if you don't fix that, you know what I'm saying? That's going to be a problem. Yeah. And I'm only going to let you know that one time before I start backing up. And then it started to get fixed immediately. But a lot of people don't, it's odor fatigue. You don't see what's wrong with you until somebody points it out. But you need somebody that has the guts to start pointing stuff out so that they know.
Wow. Unbelievable. Well, Tiff, hopefully your audience is pleased. You know what I'm saying? I think they, you know what I'm saying? They got the whole, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. We try to make sure that, like, let them know now.
What is this one called? I want the title.
Odor fatigue.
Oh, I just looked. Okay. I just texted it to see. Odor fatigue.
I thought it was going to be the carver. It's a
day.
I thought it was going to be the carver.
And not carver. George Washington. Halloween.
Not George Washington. Michael Friday 13th.
But again, man, thank you, Tiff, for, you know, kind of getting the rest of the story.
Put that over there, folks.
Keep this away.
Keep that away. Oh,
you got the podcast nerd. Whole room on edge a little bit.
Whole room on edge.
Man, big shout out to Organifi, the sponsor of this podcast. ORGANIFI.com, promo code SUCCESS. All right, get 20% off your order. Listen, man, you got to be healthy out here. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? You're running around these streets. The corona is out there.
She out there.
This is unconfirmed, but I think if you drink Organifi, you can't catch the corona.
Oh, wow.
It's just not proven by the FDA yet.
Nothing else is either, by the way.
Right.
Every time I look at something, it's like they say a whole bunch of stuff and be like, this has not been validated by anybody but Tyrone in the back.
<That's it. laughs>
You know what I'm saying? Tyrone just said it was true, so it must be.
Yeah. Call him Tyrone.
March Madness is upon us.
It's right here. Yep.
The Spartans are primed for another run to the
foe.
All right, so we are doing a bracket challenge, Carl.
Yep, but I'll have everything out. Just look for the website.
We'll
post
on
the S2S podcast page.
Go green.
All right, go white.
Let's go. Let's go.
Fam.
Marcus Liberty ain't playing, so he goes.
Right.
Marcus Liberty ain't playing, so...
Ooh, Marcus Liberty.
Back in the day, bro. Back in the day.
You got it. That's how you got to go before it. No.
I know he was nickel slick. He had to be nickel slick. Nickel slick. All right, so the bracket challenge, where can they find it at, Carl?
We're going just check the S2S IG page.
Oh, the S2S IG page, go to S2S podcast on Instagram.
Is that what do you get if you win?
We're gonna do something. Yeah, like, please. We're gonna do something.
We talked about something big. Yeah. I'll let y'all know.
Okay, yeah, maybe admittance into Make Real Estate Real. I know Mark got a couple of those
lives.
Up.
Yep.
So we could probably do something big this year. And so, also, you have Make Real Estate Real coming up March 28th
and
29th. And 29th in Chicago.
Yep, in Chicago.
Go to MakeRealEstateReal.com.
Yep.
Sign up for that. You want to go to
life changing.
Life changing.
Oh, it's insane.
Financial changing, too.
Look, you put up a post the other day. I was like, okay, I'm in tears. Did you see the one with my man? He always, I can't remember his name at this very minute, but dude, I think he's on his second or third property.
Yeah, he just got
and y'all put up a, I actually saw him at a couple of our conferences in the past, And
I didn't see the all I know. Ma.
Oh, sure. Go to Ma's page and find the post real quick.
Ma, Ernie, the hat though. How you throw the hat off, and then at the end you get the hat back.
Bro,
and put that
back. I can't go on Facebook without seeing y'all two faces.
Hey, the greatest thing inside of the camera.
No, every time I turn my phone on, the ad is there.
Both of y'all. Yeah. Both of y'all.
Well, like, I don't see my own, it don't come up.
Famous. But no, just to watch him, you know, say, there was a part in the post, and it was just a candid conversation between the two of you, and he was like, man, I've wanted to do this for years, and I've been trying to learn for years, and he said, I went through your course, and I had no more questions.
Yeah, he actually brought his father with him,
too. Yeah, that was amazing.
And his father, so this Ernie was first generation born here in America. Okay. And he was from
Not in America right now.
It's okay. I felt you though, Mark.
He was the first generation, and he brought his dad to witness.
Yeah, that was amazing. Mm-hmm.
He brought his dad to witness, and his dad had tears in his eyes. And he couldn't speak much English.
His father did,
but his father was just like, you know, and the father went up to me and just said, you know, thank you. He was able to say that.
Yeah.
And then a son actually bought a property 2 weeks ago and then just closed on a second property. And I asked him, I said, what was the purpose for the property that you purchased? And he said, it's going to now retire my dad because he's been working for so long. He came in this country and never stopped working. So he said, this property is to retire my parents.
Yeah.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
And he just said he took the model. He just took the model. And so, and he said he's been to several real estate conferences in the past, last 3-4 years. And he said this was the first one to really just throw everything out on the table.
Yeah,
and so, man, the guy, he just keeps on thinking.
Amazing post, let me tell you.
He lives in Arizona now.
If you guys want,
put it up on S2S.
Yeah, if you guys want, we'll put it on S2S. But also, if you want to go see it, it's on 9to5Millionaire. February 26th was the date, if you want to see that post. That was just incredible, and Candace and I sat there and watched it. We were both like, wow. So go to makerealestatereal.com. I got
LA,
what's up,
London? Yeah, I was going to say, let me shout out London first. We're still here. London.
Yeah, shout out to London. That was
London
amazing.
Was fire.
Amazing. Yes, it was.
Y'all will see the footage. Yeah. Check the page
great
out.
Great venue,
back
too.
The house.
Yep. You know what was crazy about the venue? It changed colors.
Yeah.
Did y'all notice that?
Yeah, I did.
Yep. I was like, wait a minute.
It changed colors.
I like when you didn't come to
third,
colors. You didn't get there to 7:30, Tiff. You know, Tiff be like, let me know when they're ready for me.
Is that time really? Yeah, I couldn't figure it out. I didn't go to sleep till 6 o'clock that morning.
No, the time change definitely throw you off a little bit, and then stay up crazy hours anyway.
That's
so.
True. Yeah. Hey, LA, you got next 4/18, y'all. We at LA April 18th, so
he's gonna be out there by 6 months early. Stay by 6 months.
All right, after LA, we going to C's hometown, Atlanta, 5/23.
Hey, I still consider the elbow my hometown.
Oh, my bad. Yeah, I'm a ATL-ian.
Home of the crack.
Yeah. For sure.
We're going to Wakanda.
When are we bringing 1% to Lansing?
Oh.
Every Saturday.
11 o'clock every Saturday. Hey, Houston, we're back to Marcus. We coming back to you. Breakfast Club. We coming to Houston.
Like
June
that?
6th.
They like that.
Oh, here he goes.
Like
he
got the week. I got a couple laughs
keep
over
going,
here.
Just keep going.
My wife's the only one didn't laugh. I said they all laughed at the 2% joke. You
know what I'm
saying?
Going,
Houston, Texas, Marcus, Breakfast Club. We coming June 6th.
Uh-oh, get your Metamucil ready. Get your Metamucil ready. See, if you don't listen to the podcast, but these are all inside jokes.
Right.
Hey, 2 weeks after that, June 20th, this is the one I'm waiting for. Honolulu, Hawaii, y'all.
Come on out to Honolulu and celebrate my birthday, y'all.
Let's go.
What's your birthday,
bro? June 22nd.
Oh, 2 days after.
We're doing it big, left side of the menu type deal.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm coming, Ma, because I want to get on one of them yachts and stuff.
No doubt. We already putting that together.
Your birthday, imagine what's about to happen.
Probably on my birthday, actually, June 22nd.
Yep. Can we get a property for what we about to do in Hawaii?
We just closed on the property yesterday.
It's done. Hey, we going to the north, 7/25, Canada, Toronto. We coming to you after that. We got Washington, D.C.
Rumor is Drake will be there.
Oh,
I can't confirm that. Tyrone told me that, too. You know what I'm saying?
Washington, D.C., October 25th, and we close the year out. Reno, Nevada, 11-14, November 14th. So that's our schedule, y'all. Get your tickets.
You said Reno. Tiff kind of looked over here a little funny.
Oh, Tiff, what's up?
Okay.
All right.
Oh, Reno, you're good. Y'all better start buying some tickets. Tiff, shut y'all down.
Right. I'm like, Reno, about to shut down. Y'all, I've been reading this thing.
You know when you listen.
Did you say D.C.? Chicago, be ready.
Oh, you did say D.C.
D.C.,
October 25th.
Chicago, be ready. Chicago be ready. I'm just saying.
Reno, y'all heard that. Y'all got a week, y'all.
You might want to call more for Ty.
And we can go to
he's trying to.
Okay. One more thing about iPhone. What? No. I may be joining you, Camille. Is there room on the Android team?
Put that on.
Is there room?
Put that on the
is
head.
There room on the Android team?
Cap.
Is there any room?
All cap.
No, Nick, no. Okay, all right, so here's the other thing I got a problem with. With iPhone, if they don't quit acting like they don't know what I'm trying to spell.
Oh, God. Oh,
that's killer.
Fam, I'm trying to spell some words, and I'm going, you know how you go too far, and then it's red, and then you go back expecting the.
Then they say no replacement.
I'm like, fam.
Yeah,
come
know
on,
that, that
y'all.
Is.
The spelling help is just terrible.
It's not helping.
I'm like, has it gotten worse?
Yeah, it has.
I'm like, what from is the deal? I can't type it. Nothing.
Yeah.
I'm just sending it out now. I'm like, whatever. And then somebody say something, one of E. Oakwood friends correct me. I don't even care. But I'm just tired of the abuse, man. I'm tired of the abuse. I'm saying, let's join together. I may start a movement. Mm. Just demanding that iPhone step up their game because it's not right.
Yeah.
And so, anybody got Cricket or Boost
in the room? A Bible phone.
It's
all ballers in here. Phone, I bet if I go back to my hometown, they're going to be like, yeah, for real, it's $19 a month. You get everything. I'm like, that sounds pretty good right now. 3% club. 3%. Go to ec3%.com.
For the Cricket.
Hey. Hey, blame it on the time zone, y'all.
Hey, instead of extreme excuse, go to moderate execution.
Cut this shit out.
I'm going
to he's not tired at all.
I'm going back to bed.
He's not tired at all. He wide awake.
Give me a shirt to just say moderate execution. I may or may not show up.
Yeah. Execution sometime.
Hey, we out of here. We'll see you next week.
I want you to focus on here right now. Don't you worry about when you get home. You make this, you concentrate on this opportunity. You don't worry about tomorrow. You concentrate on this opportunity with all your